What's happening, guys? If you love this podcast and you really want to support us, you can go to haveawordpod.com. You can get yourself some merch, something like this hoodie, something like that t-shirt. There's plenty of stuff for you to go and have a look at there. There's also links so you can buy tickets to the Have A Word live shows and also tickets to mine and Dan's tour shows if you want to come and see us do stand-up. That's all at haveawordpod.com.
We also do an extra episode of the podcast every week on patreon.com/haveawordpod. Sign up on Patreon, get the exclusive Patreon episode. There's also some discounts on merch, discount on live tickets, but the extra episode is only on Patreon. That's patreon.com/haveawordpod.
Bye, Felicia. Bye. Do you think Spanish pigeons understand English ones?
Yes. Next question.
How are you?
Okay.
Okay. That the English one?
Yeah. No, that's the Spanish. I speak a bit of Spaniola.
Good. Are ya?
Yeah, all right. Yeah, good.
Welcome back to the podcast. I'm in such a good mood, you know.
Yeah, I can tell.
In pain. Played footy for the first time in ages yesterday. Got groin strain, got hamstring strain, got shoulder pain, but I'm like enjoying it. I want to get back in the gym. I want to be fucking oos.
Why? I don't understand why you're enjoying it.
Don't know. I think it's just like, I feel like I've done something because I've been quite lazy with my exercise lately. I've put £3 back on, Dan, and...
Oh, babe.
£4 back on. And it's just making me feel, you know, like at a time like this, you know, going through a breakup can be really difficult and then you put on weight on and you're like, no, I'm actually dead happy. And I just want to get ripped as fuck and be like, oos.
I
want to be gorgeous. Right. Do you know what I mean? What I want to do is get...
What a strange thing to say. I want to be ripped. I want it to hurt me. I want to be beautiful. I want to fly. I want to sing professionally. Like, are you all right? I love it when you've had a coffee. It's so obvious. Like, I just want to be someone. I want to stand in local elections. I want to, you know, I want to be a member of the PTA.
I want to get ripped, right? So that like you can see me abs through me fucking bomber jacket, get a load of new press shots taken and then get fat again.
Right. You, I think, have seen Paul Smith recently, haven't you?
Uh-huh, yeah. Yeah,
that's exactly what happened to me when he came to do episode 76.
No, but he's 76. Keeping it on. He wants to stay like that. I just want to look good
I've
in
unfollowed
photos.
Him on Instagram.
Have you really?
Yeah, I don't want to see him. Don't want to see him. He used to be a little ginger fatty. And now he's a fucking turkey teeth.
Oh, wow.
Strawberry blonde muscle. Oh, God. Freaks me out. Well, that's good. How was the footy? How did you perform?
Oh, I was on fire, you know.
Goals?
Yeah, scored about six goals.
Did he really score six goals?
It was a two-hour football game.
Yeah.
All right, okay, good.
But yeah, I played well. I had a really satisfying moment when we were talking on the way here. I caused an own goal. Like, I beat the same man three times and then just whipped across. It was a big pitch as well. Whipped, you know, one of those dangerous crosses that I touch off anyone and it's in.
Oh, whipped across. You are overestimating your
ability. In my head, I've got Gareth Bale flying down the left wing against Inter Milan. Across. Fucking Adam Rowe and then bang. And then Maicon shits it and it goes in.
No, right. But so at one point I did exactly that. And in my head, I looked. No, but seriously, look, ask him.
Didn't.
You didn't say that in the car.
No.
Listen, I megged someone, right? I megged him, went past him. Another guy come at me. I put it round him, put me one-on-one with the goalie. And I could see the back page of the Daily Mirror with me on my shirt. And I put it well wide.
Another fella came over and he fucking punched his head in and shagged some bird. You never. Yeah. You beat two men and missed.
That was two sides of the same story. I beat this guy. I levitated. I floated.
In my head yesterday, I was playing like Shaolin soccer. Like I was jumping in the air. What the hell? Hot job!
Crouching tiger, hidden striker. He's fucking hanging in the air. Bang! Volley. Amazing. And then Carl's like, yeah, you just beat two fat men and fucking skied it.
Not these bad. Were like most of the lads we were playing against yesterday were like academy graduates of like Liverpool and that, and I was still the best player on the pitch.
You're the best player now.
He wasn't there. He doesn't know. Do you know what was annoying though?
Amazing projection.
So it was like a 9-on-9 game, but like I'm so competitive in everything I do. But there was like two or three lads on our team who just didn't care about winning. And it just it's annoying though, isn't it? Like, you know, when we concede, I'm like, what are we doing? Fucking pack it in. And at one point I was running down the right wing and there was a guy and I had acres of space and he tried to play the most complicated pass over to the left and I went, come on lad. And he went, excuse me, but I saw a pass and I just miskicked it. Is that okay with you? Do you do everything perfectly? And I was like, no. He went, well, shut up then. Because it's, it, you know, we're all playing here and we're all friends. And I was like, you fucking gimp. As if you can't like take someone going, come on. I mean, acres of space. All you have to do, a little slide through.
It's literally
rat.
Like it's the fucking Champions League semi-final. What the fuck are you doing?
In my head it is.
I want you. You know what happened with Stephen Tries and at that Wembley Cup thing? When the fucking team, but what's it? Shy FX. What's the fucking, who were they called? JLS.
The F2.
The F2, that's JLS. It. JLS. It was JLS. Yeah. Whoever they were playing and were taking it dead seriously.
JLS.
It's not the F2.
The F2.
He's not as good as the F2.
No, what I'm saying is, I cannot wait for you. This is my dream. There's so many dreams for this podcast. I want it to get big enough on the tube that they're like, oh yeah, we're doing that Wembley Cup. We should get those Have a Word guys down and like see you lose your fucking shit when I bin off across. And like, it's for charity. So we've got disabled children and the stars of YouTube just to see you scream at some kid.
I can't turn it off.
Who's trying to whip a ball in when he's like,
I can't. Like at one point, so we played first to 30, right? That was the game. First to 30 goals wins. Like, it's a long game.
And not a lot of defending going on.
No.
Okay.
At one point, our team was like 29-21 down. We lost. But we were 29-21 down. But in my head, that's still a winnable game because it isn't over yet. So I'm still trying to run around like a fucking man possessed. And everyone else is just like, it's over, isn't it? And it drives me up the fucking wall. Either play to win or just don't fucking play.
What else are you competitive in?
Everything.
Life. Football, podcasting, mm-hmm. I've seen that. Stand up, mm-hmm. But that's all good.
Anything I'm good at or want to be good at.
Right. Anything else though, like parking, shagging, what do you like?
I am competitive.
It's fucking like, race to come. Yeah!
Race to make
I've won again.
Come.
What's competitive parking?
I don't know. I just he gives off the vibe
no,
of like.
No, but like if I do parallel park and get it like right first time and it's a space just bigger than my car, I do sort of like sit in my car for 20 seconds like, whoa, see that?
I have literally reverse parked and gone, whoa. Almost just as you know when you do that. Yeah. Gerard!
Like if you get it with one, like you don't even have to readjust and you just go straight in and there's space for like your car and my dick and that's it. And you just get yourself nicely in. I do sort of look around. Bold Street in Liverpool is always chocker, but sometimes there's a space just big enough for your car. And if I just get it, I do sort of look out my window to be like, is no one watching what I've just done?
Like, I honestly want someone to just open the door, you check the distance, you're like, that's no more than my dick. And then just a random stranger to be like.
But I do sort of.
And I just go like, cheers.
I do sort of think I deserve it sometimes when you just, wow.
Also, can I just say what you've just done is reminding me. When you first pass your test, you don't do it at first because you're still like a fucking rules nonce, like doing the feed in the and fucking check your blind spot. And then as soon as you've passed, within a couple of weeks, you start fucking, I'm just gonna hold the steering wheel how I. And then the first time you reverse park like a dad, and you're like, oh my God, that's how my dad used to do it. The fucking. They're like wax on, wax off, but on the steering wheel.
I know it's almost hack, but do you know what I fucking love doing? I love the hand behind the passenger seat.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And you're just like,
oh, yeah.
Don't use your mirrors. Look out the fucking window, and then, kid.
And then like that. Just like, is everyone's pussy wet?
Yeah.
I drafted like one finger.
That's what I've started doing to Laura now. I'm like, do you need some kitchen roll? Because you must be pretty damp down there. So now that's just become code for like whenever I'm being an absolute bore, like an absolute, I'm like, oh, I really think we need to paint the outhouses because I've used a paint and it's a bit glossy and a bit shiny. And then Laura looks at me like you're a boring cunt. I'm like, do you want some kitchen roll just to get some of the dampening sorted down there?
But I really am competitive
really
with.
That really is sexy and it just fucking spin it in your hand.
It's, I play to win. Do you know what I mean?
I honestly think you're getting like thinner to just compete with me. I really do. I think we got, like, did we get a tweet in the middle of lockdown when some random girl went, is it weird that I thought of fancy Dan from the Have a Word podcast?
Fucking pissed me off.
And like, literally, so much. I'm not even joking. I was like, it is what it is. And since then, I'm a stone heavier and he's three lighter.
I was like, hey, and he's a fucking ball pedo. Look at me reverse it.
Dan, do you not play sport?
Well, good question.
He plays polo.
I love a bit of croquet. No, I'm a jogger. You know, I'm a lover. I don't know. I just like a bit of a run around. I've got some 12 kg dumbbells that I've used twice since Paul Smith came and did the podcast, and they've been outside fucking.
Have you never played footy, no, or like rugby?
Never, never in his life. Never kicked the ball.
I don't mean that, but I mean like we've played every day for like, or every month for like 20 years.
I don't have mates where I live. So who am I playing five side with? Etta and Laura. Like, come on, you're nearly four. Get the fucking cross track back, you little.
He won't do that.
Yeah. No. Daddy, I don't want to play with Adam anymore. You play like a fucking child. Grow up.
My dad used to tell me off loads when I was a kid because I used to like 2 foot my little brother. And like, that's fine now because we're both adults. But when I was like 12 and he was 8, fuck off.
Love
Let him know you're there.
That's how he learns. He's crying again. No, I don't. I'm not a bit. Yeah, I'm not. Don't play loads of sport. I've retired from cricket.
You a cricket player? Yeah.
I used to be. Ooh. Until I went in the nets in Headingley, and
in nets.
In the nets.
Like the so you've got net around so you can hit the ball.
You just have a bowl. It's just literally bowling and batting practice.
I thought I'd just totally forgot the sport of cricket and there was goalkeepers then for a second.
No, you just got. It's really poncy. Where Yorkshire Cricket Club practice in Headingley, just off the stadium. You can rent nets. And I was like, oh, I've got a bat, you know, I just have, you know, and they pad you up and everything. And a guy that we work for in Leeds called Toby Jones, loves cricket. He's a cricket obsessive. It's like how I am with NFL. He's like that with cricket. And he was bowling what I think he thought was like leg spin, where it's meant to like come out your hand and then cut back in behind your legs. And he was just basically going, it was one of the most painful experiences.
Was it Elton John?
I nearly shot. I'm still standing. I'm still bowling. One point, I stopped batting against him because he was just putting them down the leg side so much. I was like, dickhead, what are you doing? And he got a bit eggy. And then he let one go and he just hit me on the fucking head. And 15 minutes later, I had retired from cricket. Because A, I'm shit. And also, I'm having fucking morons bowl against me. So I've retired from cricket. I've never really played five-a-side.
Retired?
Yeah.
Retired.
A mate of mine from uni, his older brother, sent Sven-Goran Eriksson a letter retiring from international football duty.
That's excellent.
Literally printed it out and went, I just want to let you know that I'm no longer available for England selection. He was 24 years old and he worked in a fucking office.
It's
fucking brilliant, isn't it? Because
he
had to think about his summer plans, didn't he? You know, World Cup 2006 was coming. Oh. Funny. Playing football, is that something that you think you're going to be doing in a 1 month's time, just out of interest?
Are you talking about the inevitable second lockdown?
I cannot believe that we are using the word inevitable because this is making me feel cray cray. What the fuck is going on, Ro?
I don't really understand it because it seems like, oh, well, there's a lot of new cases at the minute, so we need to lock down. And it's like, but no one's in hospital. So if everyone in Europe's got it, but no one's sick, why are we asked? Do you know what I mean?
Does it feel like to you it's confirmation bias? Whereas I feel like the people who were going, oh, there's not going to be a lockdown in March, were like, oh, it's not going to be a lockdown because it never happened before. Then a lockdown happened. They were like, oh, like we talked about it loads at the time. There were several people who we know who were like, I don't think there's going to be a lockdown. And then 5 days later, there was a lockdown. And now it feels like it's those same people going, I think it's going to be a lockdown just because there was one. Is that the solution this time? Because FYI, it fixed fuck all. It just slowed it down, caused a recession, fucked everyone over emotionally and mentally, and now we're back in the same... What are we going to do every 5 months? Have a lockdown?
I'm not doing another proper lockdown. Like, I nearly went mental when I had a missus and a dog. I'm not fucking looking at me same four walls and wanking and playing FIFA at the same time for months. I'm just not doing it.
Sounds fantastic.
Well, but it does for about an hour and a half.
It's weird because I didn't experience lockdown. I don't know what... I wasn't here, so I don't know...
Yeah, it's a right laugh.
Yeah, it's honestly, fucking...
It's such a giggle.
I'm doing this to camera. Right. For all of our regular listeners, and I imagine there'll be some people today who listen because of Larry, or maybe you're new to the podcast and you've just found it. Just want to let you know, this podcast... And this studio is going fucking nowhere. I don't care if they lock everything down and they tie fucking old people to radiators so that they can't leave the fucking house. I will find a way to get to this studio. I'm not putting Perspex up. I've seen them every day for fucking months now. Carl's there. If I have to move into his house or his house to keep this podcast alive, it's fucking happening. I'm not doing it. It's not happening. I'm not doing another proper lockdown. Fuck your nan. Fuck my nan. Fuck everyone's nan. I'm still podcasting.
It's good because Radio 1 is still going to be podcasting.
Yeah.
And we're arguably better than Radio 1.
We're fucking well better than Radio 1.
We don't do travel. We should start doing travel. That'll validate us. Just look out the window like, yeah, there's still parking. There's loads of parking in Runcorn.
Not doing it.
How are they going to... When people keep saying full lockdown, how is it possible that that is going to happen again? Like... I don't understand how... I know loads of people aren't going to do it this time because the first time round, everyone's like, it's just going to kill so many people. Like, one in five will be dead. You know, I won't be dead. He's dead. Like, and now everyone's like, nah, it's not that bad. There's not the hospitalizations. I know it's going to increase, but how are they going to make people do it?
I'm becoming more, like, right-wing as it goes on. Just, like, not like politically, necessarily. And I would never vote right. I couldn't do it. I couldn't betray... who I am in my city in that way. Just couldn't do it. But I'm sort of just like, you know, save the economy, fuck your nan. Just for a bit, do you know what I mean?
You can tell his nan's dead, can't you? Fuck my nan, fuck your... When you said that, fuck my nan, fuck your nan, I was like, nan and Roe is dead. That's why Adam's... Everyone's watching going, oh God, he's being really flippant about his nana. No, not so much. They be dead.
But yeah, I'm just sort of like, just like, come on, like, talking to like... the lads who own Hot Water and the lads I know who run bars in Liverpool, who are just like, people are going to fucking kill themselves. I don't want to get too heavy. There's going to be business owners who commit suicide if there's another lockdown. There's so much uncertainty. Speaking, Hot Water Comedy Club are probably in the most secure position of any other comedy club, barring maybe the Comedy Store in the UK. The Comedy Store's a well-known international brand. They'll be fine. Hot Water have built essentially a tourist attraction in Liverpool that competes numbers-wise with the fucking Cavern Club now. So Hot Water are going to be fine. They've got the assets in Paul Smith, who's always going to sell tickets now. Other comedy clubs, the Glee.
The Glee's the other one that's safe financially, I bet.
Because they won a big court case a couple
against
of years ago.
Against Fox. Sued Fox about the name Glee because of the TV show and won.
Which is phenomenal.
Apart from that,
there's other comedy clubs that are going to struggle. And I'm talking to me mate who run bars in town and they're like, lad, we don't know what we're going to do. We just about survived the first lockdown. Because they've still got liabilities. They've still got to pay the rent. They've still got to pay the business rates. Like, that's all still there. And yeah, you can get a loan off the government, but you've still got to pay that back at a time when you don't know when you're going to be earning proper money again. The clubs in Liverpool, they're having to put more staff on to make less money because they've got to have someone on the door taking your temperature. They've got to have someone taking your name and your number for track and trace. They've got to have people doing table service. You can't just go to the bar and get a drink. And the longer and longer it goes on, we said it last time, we put a video, it was about Matt Hancock. Businesses are going to die. And when businesses die, people don't know what they're going to do with their lives. And people who've been running successful businesses having to go on the fucking dole and shit like that. And they don't want to. They're not like scrounging. There's not going to be any other options. And then the company goes into huge recession. There's no way to come out of it. And do you know what will happen as well? Do you know the worst part about it? The richest of the rich, the billionaires who own the buildings and all stuff like that, they're in a position where a bar closes because the owner can't fucking pay the rent anymore. And a fucking billionaire comes in and goes, well, I'll just put my business in it. I'll just put that, and it's fucking driving me mad.
Do you know, I mean, there's two things there about everyone being forced into recession. It raises the poverty line.
Yeah.
And when the poverty line raises, children suffer. So this thing about, like, we've got to look after who? Who? People that are retired, that have their pension, that should be isolating. And I'm not trying to just be dismissive of anyone over a certain age. But if you're vulnerable and you're old and your house is paid off and you've got a pension, stay the fuck in your house and tell your grandchildren to leave you alone. Yeah. I'm sorry. That's it. Because if everything shuts down, if everything shuts down, kids are forced in, like, under the poverty line. And that brings huge, like, medical, like, emotional problems, like, it's so frightening. But what I don't get about that is, if businesses are abandoned, how does that serve? If you're a Tory landowner or a Tory landlord, how does it serve to have your premises empty?
But that won't be
awful.
Empty. They won't be, because
the high street is fucking dying. If you walk down the high street, every third venue.
Yeah, sorry, I'm thinking bars.
It's
but
gone. And what happens is, when people just lose out, like, what we see is we see, like, tenants and everything, but there'll be mortgages on those buildings. So if they default on those mortgages, then it goes to the banks. Like, this recession has a knock-on effect. It's not like Tories are just sat there going, let's impoverish the country. Traditionally, and this is a bit oversimplified, the rich want the poor working, because that money is generated, it all ends up back in their pocket. If businesses are empty, if businesses close down, if people are on the dole, that doesn't serve any Tory well. Like, where is the common sense of, like, I get it, the restrictions, the spacing, all of the fucking face, mask, dick, all of that stuff, I understand. But to lock everything down, it's almost like just paying off your horrific debt with another high interest debt. It just knocks the problem down the line. It doesn't solve the problem. And this government cannot sort track and trace to save its fucking life. So we lock down in the trust that, like, this gives you time to sort it out so we don't have to do this again. Right, if you're feeling symptoms, I know you live in Rochdale, but could you drive to Aberdeen to find out if you've got COVID? Fucking ridiculous. I cannot believe a lockdown is on the cards.
It's bullshit, and I'm not, look, by the way, we've said this before, but we're very conscious at the minute that we're getting a lot of new viewers and new listeners. Everything we say on this, especially like this, we don't plan any of this, is all free-form nonsense. Don't listen to us. We're not giving you advice. We're just talking. We're just emptying our fucking heads, because this is an avenue for us to do that in. Don't take any of this as advice. Don't take this as me going, you should do this, you whatever. I'm not doing another lockdown. It's not fucking happening.
But where will you go on your I'm not doing a lockdown?
Here? What here. I mean is, I'm coming here and I'll run illegal gigs. I will text everyone in my phone book and be,
it's not a Patreon episode.
I don't give a shit.
Oh my God.
I'm
just
done.
I just assumed you was doing a Patreon thing, like leaning
in. If
everyone.
The country's locked down and you still want to come and see stand-up comedy in some fucking derelict basement that I managed to put a fucking generator and these fucking studio lights in, the option's going to be there, okay? I am fucking done. I will kill myself. My mental health will go down. I just about survived the first lockdown, and at the time, I had a missus and a dog, and we were trying to make things work. Me, in a three-bedroom house on my own, looking at fucking photos of a relationship that's gone down the fucking toilet. While I've got no comedy and I'm not allowed to come and see you in here. It's not happening. I'm not doing it. Suck me dick. I will find a way to make comedy work. And if you want to come, message me. Message me on social media. I'll tell no one. I'll let you know when it is. And I swear to God, if there's any fucking busies who listen to this podcast and come and shut me down, I'll burn your fucking house down.
Edit note.
So how big was the coffee that you had?
Actually was, I got a...
This is because he's fucking scored 6 goals at 5 aside.
Remember early on when I told you I like to rob things from shops?
What did you rob?
Went in the Tesco, right, and they've got a Costa machine. Yeah? So,
Bad boy.
I went over
what
to it.
What you gonna do? What you gonna do when they come for
got a lot. So the way it is, you select what you want, and then it prints a little receipt, and you take the receipt to the till, and it's like, this is the receipt for this coffee, and they scan the receipt, and then you pay for that. Boy. So I got a large coffee cup, yeah?
Yeah.
Nice. And then I pressed regular Americano. So there was still space in it. Then,
doesn't give a fuck.
Then I got an espresso, tipped that in, and just took the receipt for the regular coffee.
This guy. Don't give a shit.
This is a comedy podcast and none of it is to be taken seriously. I'm totally lying.
He just threatened to burn down police houses. But apart from that, this is what's really edgy. Paid for a regular, got a large.
No, it's not that. I paid for a regular. I only put a regular in, but then I also put an extra shot of coffee in.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So I essentially got like a £4.50 coffee for £1.88.
When it come for you,
which is fuck. That's a good deal, lah.
Good deal. Yeah, so also a good deal if you just take the coffee and walk the fuck out of the shop.
That's what he said. You know, when you just walk out with it, it's like, because that's not the game. I can afford the coffee. I'm not doing it to steal it. I went to the till and he was with me. I went, there's an extra shot in that coffee.
A good deal.
I said it to her.
Have you got a new Ford Escort? No, I just found a car with the keys in the ignition. Just drove off with it. I think it's worth about £4,500. Good deal.
I went to the woman.
It's like Robin Hood. I didn't have a Ford Escort. I'm poor. And now I've got a Ford Escort.
I went to the woman. I had a meal deal and me coffee. And I went, there's an extra shot of coffee in that. And then I handed her me. But the woman who works there is a bit fucking dozy. And I know that because she's saved me before. So I gave her the coffee. It was like, extra shot of coffee in that. And then I gave her the receipt and she just scanned it. And I was like, I did my job. I walked up. I told her there's an extra shot in it. And if she'd have gone, oh, there's a second receipt, you need to go and get that as well. I'd have gone, do you know what? Today I lost the game, and I'd have gone and got it, and I'd have paid full price for me coffee. But she just scanned me thing and gave me it for the price. And if anything, that means she robbed it.
I love it how your head works.
Double jeopardy.
I'm trying to make them better. I'm stealing from them to try and make them better at the job.
The worst amazing. Mystery shopper in the world.
I said, oh God, we have to have a fucking interval. I need to lose some weight. My fucking tits are hurting. Oh, you did an Instagram post you want to talk about?
I do actually, yeah. Are you playing the deaf mum music?
Oh no, sorry.
What?
I just looked over at Colin.
It wasn't that, it was something else.
What was it?
It doesn't matter, I'll say it there.
No, go on, tell us what it is.
When you said interval, do you mean now?
Yeah, but not right now.
Okay, yeah.
Because I'm going to do this first.
Yeah. No, I thought you were doing, because I knew what we were going to talk about. And I was being a dick, and I thought Carl was going, no, we joke, hey, we joke a lot about a lot of things, but his dead mum, fuck his nana, she's long gone, but his mum in Everton, you don't fucking joke, and words, you don't joke about words. Sorry, go on.
Sorry. Oh, so, not yesterday. What date is it?
Yesterday.
No, it was 2 days ago. So the 15th of September is the anniversary of Mama Ro croaking it. my mum died on the 15th of September, 2013. And so it was 7 years since we lost her 2 days ago. And I just had a moment where, like, I've done stand-up material, right, about... like people who are sort of just attention seeking and using family deaths to get like likes and comments on Facebook. And I've always been like, oh, it's just like, oh, my mum's dead. So tell me I'm amazing. And I've done jokes about that because it sort of fits with my brand. But the other day I was just like very hypocritical. And I don't really give a shit because I just like, I had a moment. It seemed such a long period of time. And because I'm 28, like because it's like seven is a factor of 28. I was like, that's a quarter of my life that my ma's been gone for. So I put like a post on Instagram and Facebook, just sort of emptying me brain of the thoughts I had about it. And like, you know, I never really felt like I've dealt with it because I've never cried a lot. And I feel guilty about not thinking about her enough. And just how amazing she was and how she brought up me and my little brother, despite the fact she was like a raging alcoholic, like a bottle of vodka or two bottles of vodka a day towards the end. Which is a fucking, that's a shift.
That is commitment.
That's my line on stage. I say, I talk about, I go, people call it addiction. It's not, it's commitment to the sport of drinking. Never drank a bottle of vodka and woke up the next day and thought, again.
Champions League boozing.
And I just wanted to say thank you because a lot of the podcast listeners, but also just my followers in general, I've had like hundreds of messages from people saying, thank you for talking about your mum. Thank you for being honest about it. And stuff like that. And we don't do a lot of serious stuff on this podcast because it's not meant for that. We want this podcast to be a funny break for people. But yeah, I think it's just like, I forget how good it is to talk. There's been We get a lot of messages every week from people going, funniest podcast in the world, we love it, and we're very grateful for all that, but there's been moments on this podcast throughout, and if you're new to this and you haven't really gone back and listened to the whole thing, you don't have to. It's not a topical thing, and you don't need to know what happened 40 episodes ago to get this week's. But like, we spoke about my health anxiety at one point, because that was serious, we had a lot of people get in touch about that. The last time we spoke about my mum, we had a lot of people get in touch about that, and I just wanted to say, like, if you have lost someone, or especially due to COVID, or you've lost someone around COVID, you haven't been able to see them at the last bit, and talk to people about it, talk, because people understand. And I felt, when I put that post up the other day, I felt a bit sort of, because when I see posts like that, I'm always like, I understand you're grieving, but, and I need to judge people less, because I put that up, and the unbelievable amount of love and affection and kind messages from people saying, look, you being that honest about me mum has made me feel like I can be honest and say this about me. So many people, it was dead nice.
And you did it well as well. Like, a lot of people just, I just cringe a little bit when like someone goes, Nana Beverly, gone too soon, 84. You're like, not too soon, no, really. So good, you know, good innings. As a retired cricketer, I know that that is a good innings. But you did it honestly, and I think if you want to track back as well, if you've just found the podcast on YouTube in the last sort of 6-7 weeks, or from episode 67 when we had Paul Smith on, we've got the full episodes on YouTube. If you're wondering, like, why is it just episode 67? Because this was a podcast at the start of January. We started the podcast just in audio form, and we've built it from there. And at about episode 17, 18, we went into the lockdown. So at the start of this episode, if you're watching this going, God, that was a lot about almost politics and the lockdown, like that seems really out of character with this pod. It absolutely isn't. Like, we, if you want to hear a diary of that lockdown, go back to episode 15 when we first mentioned it, and we basically chart the mental health of two bellends via a Zoom meeting. And we've had moments where you've talked about your health anxiety, where we've talked about, like, told stories about addiction and your mum's death, and some of my favorite moments of this podcast. But just to follow up on what Adam said, people message us privately and tweet about stuff all the time. And there is a little bit of a community developing online, on Twitter particularly, of people who listen to the pod and interact with us. And we get a lot of messages. Sometimes we read it, sometimes we don't. We just had a listener that was in hospital getting surgery. We posted about it. She reposted it and then got a lot of love from other
have-a-worders. Sorry, because you just said sometimes we read it, sometimes we don't. We absolutely read everything. I certainly do. I will read everything. But
oh, I meant on the pod.
Read it out.
Sorry. Some we don't like say on the podcast.
Well, some people ask us not to. They just want to talk.
But if you're going through something, I know we're making light, and we're some of it's like real anger. Some of it's a genuine annoyance. But we're happy doing what we do, and we'll get through it. We've got it in perspective. But if you're going through something mentally, and you're going through something with your health anxiety, message us or post it on Twitter with our listeners, and you will find support, even if it's just someone commenting, or even if it's a genuine question where you need a bit of help. Our listeners, the people who've been listening from the start, are so tuned into this stuff. And that's why Adam got that response, I think, on Instagram. And that's why we get such a positive vibe from Twitter, because people do look after each other. So just throw something out there, you'll get a response.
And just before we go to a break, I want to tell my favourite story about me mum. And I might have said this to you before on the podcast, and maybe the people who've been listening from day one already know it. You'll know what it is. But I just want to tell it again, because I think it might be a nice clip to put out from this, because just to sort of round off me week, I haven't spoke about it so much. So have I told you me mum was very superstitious and about the birthdays? Have I told you that story?
Go on.
So in 2013... right, the year she ended up dying, it's quite a big year for birthdays in our family. I turned 21 in January. My mum turned 50 in May. And my little brother was turning 18 in the December. Now, my mum was quite superstitious. So this was about March. So I'd already had my birthday. And I'm sat in my mum's bungalow with her. And she goes, Adam, what day was your birthday on this year? And I said, it was a Friday, mum. And she goes, oh, right, because my birthday, your birthday and Jack's birthday, always on the same day of the week every year. Don't know whether you know that. And I didn't, but then I've checked it and it is every year, apart from, I think on leap years it might change, but then it changes back the year after. Always on the same day of the week, right? So I was like, oh, yeah, cool. And she goes, so Friday? And then she went, oh, no, no. And I go, what? And she goes, well, that means our Jack's birthday and his 18th as well. That will be on Friday the 13th this year. It's so unlucky to have such a big birthday on Friday the 13th. And she sat there for like a minute, just like quiet watching the telly. And then she went, oh, no. I'm turning 50 as well. And my 50th is going to be on Friday the 13th. And I said, it absolutely fucking won't, because your birthday is the 24th of May. And that's just a little insight into who my mum was as a fucking person. Absolutely the most wonderful love and care and mother that this world has ever seen. Dead intelligent with most things and a stupid fucking twat with so much other stuff. I love her and I miss her and I like telling that story. So there you go. Let's have an advert. What's happening, guys? Today's sponsor is beer52.com. They are the UK's number one craft beer discovery club.
And they've teamed up with us to give our listeners a free case of beer.
That means you get 8 free beers, an award-winning beer magazine, and a tasty snack as your first free order.
And it's free. You pay nothing. You just pay the £5.95 postage and packaging.
You'll then be a member of their Craft Beer Discovery Club, and they send you a different theme of beers every month. Past themes have been the beers of Belgium, the beers of Korea, California, all over the world. Every month, a new theme, and they're always a belter.
You'll find craft beers that you'll never find on your own, and also, you can pause your membership at any time.
So do us a favour, support the podcast, support our sponsors, go to beer52.com/word. That's beer52.com/WORD.
Every time you sign up, we get a little bit of money, so you get your free beers. There's a little bit of money to support the podcast. It's win-win. I'm a member. I love it.
Let's get back to the podcast. But go and get some beers. Pause it here. Go and get some beers.
Beer52. So we have... what? That was, is that just because I was so silent?
No.
Oh, you were eating dicks.
I wasn't.
He wasn't. Was he licking dicks?
It was because you were like... off, it makes no sense on audio, but Dan was very quiet and very pensive for like 10 seconds.
Oh, I was just trying to be a pro and leave a nice clean edit point. But whenever now, and if you've not watched before, the only way I can see him eating dicks, because I've got such prominent, like, there you go, is by watching it on the camera, because we've got the selfie thing. So now I'm getting weird about watching this at distance with shit eyes already, and then you're like... You were doing that though, weren't you?
No.
You were licking dicks.
No. I just done that one then when you were looking at the camera, so that...
Right. It's really insensitive considering our guest. You fucking prick. Nick Worth has messaged...
She's been coming to the secret gig.
She says... I don't want to assume gender. I wouldn't do that. They say... Did you just have a pube in your mouth? Mate,
it's a woman.
How fucking deep... How deep do you go into the licking dicks thing? He's there going... And then he just went... I was like, oh my God.
Were you drinking dicks then?
No, I took a chewy out of my mouth.
No, but it looked like you've been literally licking dicks so much that you went, oh God, pube. Oh shit, imaginary pube. Nightmare when you get one in your mouth. Nick Worth, they have sent a message going, sorry, she sent a message going, hi both, I have a would you rather for Carl. Would you rather spend a week in Adam's body or a week in Dan's body, living their lives, doing everything they would normally do? Thanks for the laugh.
Can I tell Nick. You right now, before he answers, I know exactly what he's going to say. He's going to pick mine just so he can ruin my life.
Look at this. Liam has also said, if you could do a Freaky Friday body swap with each other, what would be the first thing you did in each other's bodies? And then Ashley Bowman's put, Grandad and the Yeti, if you swap bodies for the day, what mayhem would you cause? And Grandad, would you go to the hairdressers, you know, treat yourself to a chip trim? Oh, I love that just at the same time, three listeners independently have gone, yeah, I think I've just watched Freaky Friday and I'd like to know what Have a Word would do with it. First of all, before we do our body swap, Freaky Friday, what would you do?
But just before he even does that, because I'll forget about this if it goes out my head. So obviously, like our regular listeners will know, I recently broke up with a long-term girlfriend who has left and she finally left the house and I went back to it the other day and I was so nervous to get a shower because it's ended really amicably and quite nice, apart from a couple of things. But I was just like, she was being so nice that I was suspicious. And when I got a shower, I picked up my shampoo and I nearly didn't use it because I was like, she could have filled this with hair removal cream. And I thought it was going to be a fucking seal.
Hair removal cream would be fucking brutal. But
I'm sure she hasn't done anything, but I'm throwing all the food away. I'm throwing all the salt and pepper away because I'm like, that could be arsenic now. I'm throwing away all the shampoo. I've had a shower with the shampoo.
She thinks she's got murderous tendencies.
I think she would love to just fuck me up a little bit.
Yeah, but not like arsenic. Arsenic. Laxatives is banter, innit?
I emptied like a bit of the shower gel out before I used it in case she'd put like blue ink in or something and turn me into a smurf.
Fucking peroxide.
Yeah.
Holy shit. I would love to see you, Romanian national team, 2002 style.
See, my brain immediately goes to the Stan video. Yeah. Dear Dan, I wrote you, but I'm not coming to the studio.
I like that, Dan. Dan Petrescu.
It was 2000. It was Euro 2000. Yeah, the Romanian national team in unity all dyed their hair blonde. It was really embarrassing because if you watch the replay of that, we got knocked out of Euro 2000s by a load of fucking Biebers, basically. It was really annoying.
I'd choose Adam.
Right.
I'd shave me head.
Shave? You're going for a shave?
Bald.
Have you ever, bick it?
Every bit of hair in his body is gone.
Can I just say?
Freezer from Dragon Ball Z in a final form.
His life is more fun than mine. And I love you, Laura, and I love being a dad. But I've just had two afternoons off, and I spent every fucking minute of it in the garden, chopping down shrubbery and making a bonfire. Now, personally, I quite enjoy that shit. Secretly, I'd like to get cocaine and do that, but I've got responsibilities. And I don't know if you know about parenting. You can't pick your kid up from nursery when you've got class A's in your system. It's just frowned upon, like, I had a good day. Well, she's not eating anything, is she not? I can understand why. Right, but if you lived in my body, you'd be like, Laura would be like, right, can you do? And it'd be dull for you. Mm. He, even though I'm not saying he lives a fantastic, exciting life, yesterday he played fucking five-a-side, he eats dicks. He's having fun, isn't he? You've got more options with him.
But his life would be untenable after 7 days of me having it.
Full 7 days you're taking?
Oh, it would be untenable.
A week in the life of our Row?
I'd book as many gigs in as possible and be as racist as possible.
I thought you were going to say you're going to come on the podcast and be racist. Like, well, bad dad.
No, he's talking, he'd be dropping N-bombs, P-bombs. He'd be calling people. He would ruin me life.
No, he wouldn't.
No, Dan.
He loves you.
No.
Also, he now part owns a podcast that you are part of. Why would you do that to yourself?
Dan, listen to me, right? I'm telling you right now, I love him so much. And if I could run him over, I would. Our friendship from the start has been built on like a strong, like you can't be best friends with someone unless you know where, when and how you're going to kill them.
It's always
killing.
If you go enough under the surface with Row, it will end in murder. What would you do if you could be another person for I'd just go on a killing spree, okay? What would you do if you could go back in time? Oh, I'd go back to like the 1800s and kill loads of women. What would you do if you could be Carl for the day? Oh, I'd kill someone and then myself. Ah, like, murder it doesn't always have to be about murder.
Oh, look, I just, like, the thought of killing someone knocks me sick.
Right? Do you know if he's nice to me?
No, it doesn't.
Do you know if he's nice? If he's nice to me or I'm nice to him, we're like, what's wrong?
Yeah.
What are you doing?
Yeah.
Like
I know what you mean.
If he says something and he needs like a shoulder to cry on, the shoulder is stop being a fucking
yeah,
quilt.
Yeah, stop being a, yeah,
stop
okay.
being a quilt.
Well, that's, I mean, traditionally that has been a lot of British friendship on it. Like, you know, come on, you funny. She left you 2 weeks ago.
It's really like, healthy, toxic masculinity, innit?
But you're supportive when it counts. Like, I can't handle that banter. I'd be like, Adam, can we have a little bit of a word? I'm more of a vagine than that. I've watched you two together. It is a little bit, it's intense. But to be in his body for a week, to shave his head so he's big bald, PS, would not look good, right? Are you competitive about that? Are you genuinely getting annoyed? I'm saying you look better with hair. Oh my God, Adam.
But you didn't say that, did you? That's okay to say.
It would not.
You'd look better with hair as well. Everyone looked better with hair. What you said is, I wouldn't look good.
I'm going to make a picture and slide it in now of you bald.
Full bald. Full. Right. I'm just saying, that is a bit of bounce. Doing an Eminem moment. Will the wheel turn slightly? Please. That would be funny. But to go on at like a gig, like the Jonathan Ross stand-up show, like, oh, we thought you were really good the first time round, and we're going to want you on to do the second series. We're filming it, weirdly, next week. And then Carl goes on and goes, all right, you massive!
Was that supposed to be Jonathan Ross?
Oh, it's a fucking...
Because it sounded more like Elmer Fudd.
I thought he thought I'd put it there.
Just say his ass is W's. It's that easy, isn't it?
Yeah. That's not the point I'm making, boys. I think we're getting lost in the weeds.
Adam, what?
Would you really go on? No, you wouldn't.
I'd do subtle things. Like, do you know what I'd do? I'd go on his ex.
Fuck his credit up.
That's... I'd go on his ex-girlfriend.
Fuck it up. I guarantee you the only thing you could do to my credit rating is fix it.
I'd go on his, not his ex, it was ex-ex. I'd go like a year down in an Instagram.
Start liking.
And just like one.
I've never told you this, right? Oh, this is funny.
I'd do subtle shit.
I've never told you this.
That's evil, I like it.
So.
Is it the Facebook one?
Yeah. Have I told you it?
I was there, so I worked it out.
So, this was about 6 years ago or something. How long have you been with Serica?
Coming up to 9 years.
So, is Mrs.'s best mate?
Put a ring on
that her. I know of. She's got other, the one that I knew is a girl called Stacey. And I met Serica and Stacey before Carl did, because I work with them both at a nightclub. And we were in Carl's once playing FIFA, and he went to the toilet and he left his phone just on the bed. And I went to Stacey's Facebook profile, scrolled through like 4 years of profile pictures, and then just liked three in a row. Because it's so subtle. Because like, if you comment something, they can reply and then you can be like, what the fuck? I didn't write that comment. But if you just like something from years ago, what that says is, hey, I've been looking.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's subtle.
I was just trying to cause murder.
Do you want to know the less subtle version of that? This is about 10 years ago. Me and my best mate, Bondi, who is a very well-paid moron, we were hungover in a cafe in Manchester after a very boozy night out. And as a joke, I was like, if you give me your phone for a minute, you can have my phone for a minute and we can do anything you want, right? So...
Hang on.
Wow.
So he took my phone and I took his. I think he sent something like, he tried to find a girl, like an ex-girlfriend, and went, oh, I really miss you or something, and I've always fancied you. He sent it to what he thought was my ex, completely misjudged it. It was just a girl that I'd known, nothing romantic, and like a message like that to my Auntie Carol, who the next day message went, oh, I think you sent a wrong message to me. And I went, yeah, I did, Auntie Carol. She went, right. I had his phone for a minute and I know how to work fucking multiple texts. So I wrote, I'm so fucking horny right now. I wish I was deep inside you. And then just started fucking picking women's names in his phone. I sent it to six girls. Yeah. Fucking hell. Half an hour later, we got a call from one of his dental mates that was on his honeymoon with his wife, new wife.
No.
And I had sent...
No.
I had sent, I am so fucking horny right now. I wish I was deep inside you. Bundy! Oh, Bundy got a phone call going, right, I want to fucking know why you think it's acceptable to send that fucking message to my new wife on our fucking honeymoon. And he had to be like, oh, right. My mate's a fucking idiot and he had my phone. And I was sat, oh, you know when you're like hot and like sweaty because you know you've done something bad, but also you're really proud of yourself because you're a massive raging twat.
That's so funny.
That's evil, isn't it? Gee, don't play that game with me.
I did something bad to Rob Mulholland once. Comedian Rob Mulholland, who will at some point be a guest in this studio.
That's made me feel sweaty retelling that story because of, you know, when you've got like...
It's fucking brilliant.
Like a memory of like, I remember his Bondi's faces. He was like, go on, tell me the Rob story. Fucking that's got me sweaty.
I was doing the gig at Tiger in Leeds that Alan Anderson runs with Rob Mulholland. Rob was comparing. and he goes on to compare. And before the show, he was newly single at the time. He's been in a long-term relationship for a while now, but he was newly single. And he was on Tinder, and he was like, this is a girl I was fucking a few years ago, and we've just matched on Tinder, you know, I'm sort of thinking like I could sort of go and see her again for a bit or whatever, now that I'm single. And then he went on stage, but he left his phone open on the conversation with that girl. And she, the last message she'd put is, so why have you broke up with your missus? And I put, to be honest with you, I'm so glad we've matched because I realised that it was never as good as it was when I was with you. I think I love you and I think we should start building a life together. And he come off, he was
so emotionally devastated to get the second text of, from Rob Ball and going, no, that were a bit of banter. She's like literally on right move, like, oh my God, we just need a two bed place. We're in love again. Don't let, like, I'd never do that level of banter if it was just sat on the table, because then I'd be in the wrong completely. But if you've done the phone swap moment,
yeah,
then it's like, we've made a little deal.
Well, we've grown up a bit now, because when I'm...
Yeah, I don't think I'd do it now.
Whenever we're together at the minute, I'm always driving. So when we come here, he lives in the next road to me, so I pick him up and we drive here. It's stupid to bring both our cars. So he has the password to my phone now, and he can put songs on. But we sort of have, like, a sort of unspoken rule, but I reckon this is the rule. Like, if he logs onto my phone with me passwords to put the music on, he wouldn't do anything. But if I left that open there, and that's my fault, I went to the toilet.
Gentleman's agreement.
Yeah. That's the, we haven't even spoken about that, have we? But that's the, if that was open, you'd do something.
I've, like, nipped in behind, haven't I?
Yeah.
Broke the offside.
You put a security tag in the back of his jacket.
Yeah.
And didn't
work. I found it, like, 2 days later. I found it before he put that on Twitter, yeah.
It's brutal. The unwarranted, that's... Oh, no, but then that's what you're saying, isn't it? Basically, when I give you the phone to do something, don't be a dick about
it. Yeah, but the thing is, like, if you did that, I'd be like, what are you doing? But I know him, so I know he's going to do it. I know I've got to lock that phone so that he doesn't do that.
Also,
and it's been there for 12 years of best friendship.
And also, people who do the... is it called a face, right? When you take the phone and you do that, you can tell who's good at it. Because you're trying to score, but if you swing for the fences and be like, oh, I've got the phone. I fuck kids. I really love fucking kids. Fucking Facebook update. Everyone goes, oh yeah, that's an obvious someone's nicked your phone. Well, also just being like, I don't know. I probably shouldn't have voted leave. You're like, that's boring. You need to score without going for the fucking too big a shot.
The best, most horrendous one that I've seen of a Facebook attack like that.
Oh, is that what, have we changed the name?
About Ryan from Beer Colour?
No, I'm talking about Tony's.
Hang on, have we changed the name to Facebook attack?
You'll see why in a second.
Right, okay. I'll tell Tony's.
You tell Tony's in a sec. So this one that I seen.
I love it how we've just literally never talked about this and we've unearthed a file of stories that we didn't know we had. Because we've done so many episodes, we're like, yeah, what should we talk about? And now they're like, oh, this is a whole new file.
So there's a lad I know and he's a dead lovely lad. Like, and he's just a nice guy. I work with him in bars and stuff. And I had him on Facebook and this was so brutal. And I was like, what the fuck is going on? So I seen his Facebook update. And there was two right after each other on my timeline. So the first one was a post. And the second one was new profile picture from this person. The post said, guys, I'm coming off social media for a bit. You're all going to read something about me in the Liverpool Echo tomorrow that I hope my closest family and friends know isn't true. Oh. I really appreciate the support. I'd really appreciate support during this time. If you've got my number, feel free to message me. And then he changed his profile picture, not to a picture, just to the words, I am not a rapist. And I seen that and I was like, what's he done? What the fuck is going on? Oh my God. I thought I knew this, lad. And it turned out it was just his mate dicking around.
His mate is an evil genius.
His mate also changed the password to his Facebook so he couldn't get in and change it.
Oh my God. And that is the absolute masterstroke.
Tony's is
Is it Tony?
we won't say the names. But
that moment when you're trying to log into your Facebook and your nana's ringing you and you can't, you're literally trying to send an email to Facebook and you can't keep on the app because your phone keeps going off going, love, I've just read something online. What have you done? Amazing. So,
Tony borrowed his friend's, he's like, lad, can I ring such and such, gives you phone. So he's got snide access. So you don't say no to that, do you?
No.
In a pub with all the footy lads, they're all there. Tony goes out. He changes in the contacts his number to his name is now Mum. So Tony's name in the phone is Mum. And he switched Mum to Tony. So they switched around. So when Tony texts this lad, it comes up Mum.
Mum.
So he's deleted all history of texts. So it's not like it's obvious. There's no previous text to read. And he texts.
Another genius move. This is horrendous, you know.
So gives him his phone back, leaves it an hour, and then texts off his phone, like on the sly.
Leaves it an hour. The control.
Yeah.
The restraint.
So up pops Mum on his phone. Text off Mum. I'm on a night out. Maybe she wants to know if I'm okay.
I just want to say at this point, you've actually got something slightly wrong here. He went one step further than this. So he did delete all the messages, but then he mirrored the conversation he'd had with his mum.
Okay, yeah.
So the previous messages from his own phone now looked identical to the conversation he'd been having with his mum. So like it wasn't like it popped up and there was no previous message. He'd be like, this isn't from me mum, because there'd be me past messages with me mum.
Okay, so
who the fuck is this guy?
Who the fuck is that guy?
So anyway, he's waited an hour and he's got his phone and he texts this lad. Up pops mum. I won't say his name. Blah, blah. Your dad's gone out. I want you to come home and bang me. So up pops mum. Name, your dad's gone out. I want you to come home and bang me.
I think you've got that wrong.
Are you sure?
I'm almost certain, and I'll be happy to be corrected if I'm wrong, and we'll try and find it, or we'll speak to him in a bit, and we'll clarify it. I know you're wrong.
Why?
So he said, he didn't say your dad's gone out. He said, whatever his dad's name is, let's say it's John.
Yeah.
They went, John's gone out now, and Tony's out. Come round and fuck me.
Yes, that's what I mean.
No.
No.
No, Carl, you've really, you've made it.
So she wasn't trying to get her son to shag her. She was basically going, she was like, my husband's gone out and my kid's out. I've got an empty house, come and fuck me. And he was like, what the fuck's this, mum?
He's fake replicated a missent text.
He went home, the lad went home. Straight from the club, ran home, and then rang, was like, lad, what the fuck are you doing? And it's just him and all the footy lads screaming, crying, laughing down.
Yeah. So it like made out his mum was having a full-blown affair.
That's it. Sorry, I've got the mixed up day right there.
Yeah. I mean, Carl, pretty critically. Also, the way you tell stories is really ominous because of your fucking deep, soft
scouts.
He's
in the dark over
and
there.
And then this happened. It feels like a really seedy Thomas the Tank Engine episode. Like, and then Thomas phoned his mum and she wanted to get Thomas's dick. It did. It felt like, I was like, more sinister. But that is so genius. He's, the level of control to A, replicate the conversation and then wait when you're like, in your head, you're like,
all the power.
But then.
It's so fucking unbelievably brutal.
It's fucking genius.
If you are watching this or listening to it and you've got a story like this, if you've got done one of these things to your mates, if they've done something to you or you just know of someone who's done something to someone else, get them into haveawordpod@gmail.com because I reckon there's going to be an abundance of those.
Mate, we love the prank stuff. I love relationship ones as well.
Haveawordpod@gmail.com.
When people in a relationship fuck with each other, literally go, I want to mess with you so much that I know I'm not going to get sex for a week.
Shout out to Danielle, by the way. She came to watch us in Blackpool last week. Serica's friend. She's a massive fan of the pod. Like, she was fangirling so much. She had messages from years ago from sixth form where a lad had sent her, like, you're fit, a week, message back, oh, you're fit, you, can we go out? For, like, 6 months, these messages. And she was showing my girlfriend in the car, whenever it was, last year. And she was reading them, going, ah, look how sad this lad is who we used to know. And Serica accidentally blue-thumbed them. The big fucking blue thumb.
That lad must have been like, fucking hell, it took a long time, but it came back round. Still got it, Graham. Fucking Bellend.
10 years, and he messaged going, what's this? And she went, oh, sorry, I must have done that in my pocket. And he said, fucking hell, you've done well to do that in your pocket, but I'll just leave it, eh?
Oh, yeah. And then he said, he's like wanking, going, yeah, come on.
Well, yeah, showing to the lads, hey, look.
I play the long game.
Tell me she's not interested. Tell me she doesn't want a bit of Darren's dick.
2010, send the fucking message and it comes back.
They try and resist all they can, but they always come back to Darren.
Mate, there has been literally fucking, we've got like things bouncing off Pluto quicker than you potentially getting a thumbs up. We've found another galaxy quicker than you've got a thumbs up for some bird who doesn't want to bang you. That was loads of fun.
It was. Let's have a break and come back after the break with today's guest, Laddie Dean. You're going to love him. What's happening, guys? Today's episode is brought to you by Manscaped. Manscaped are the best male grooming products on the planet. They've only just launched in the UK. They've sent me and Dan a razor each, and I've got to say, proper top tier stuff. This is the best razor I've ever used. It's the first time I've ever shaved me balls and not snagged the bag. They're good, aren't they?
I get the little, you know, I get a little bit of like over the pubes tub and I nick that. I've just been using an old head trimmer. I've used this and you're like, oh, that's a slide, that's a glide. So you don't get that sting in the shower.
Yeah, it's horrible. When you get like a little cut on your bag and then you get a bit of ball sweat seeping into the cut and you get sweaty sting.
Keep talking sexy, Adam. That's why Manscaped has redesigned the electric trimmer. This is it. They've engineered the greatest ball hair trimmer ever created. It's the new and improved Lawnmower 3.0, and it's just been released in the UK. It's smart as fuck. This is their third generation trimmer. It features a cutting edge ceramic blade to reduce manscaping accidents.
And when I'm saying this is the best razor I've ever used, I'm not messing, you know. I know it's easy to say that when you're getting sponsored by a company, but it's really, really, really good. The battery's amazing. It lasts for an hour and a half, so you can shave for longer. It's water resistant. You can use it in the shower. You don't have to be shaving stood over the toilet anymore. It's sick.
One of the coolest features is the LED light. It illuminates the way as you shave along so you don't get any nasty nicks. And they've just got an upgraded 7,000 RPM quiet stroke motor. The nicest bit, you get a load of kit when you get this sent to you, but the charging stand is charged by USB and it looks sleek as fuck. So you're not getting any whinging from your partner, your missus. It's gonna sit in the bathroom. You're gonna be proud of it.
Look, don't take our word for it. If you're listening to this, watching it, pause the podcast here. Go and order one for us. And they don't just sell razors. You can get all sorts of male grooming products from manscaped.com and experience it for yourself. It's really, really good. Your balls will thank you.
This is the important bit. Every listener of Have A Word gets 20% off. Get 20% off and free shipping with the code WORD. That's WORD, W-O-R-D at manscaped.com. And make sure you use that code. Otherwise, they won't know that we sent you.
That's right, 20% off, free shipping all over the UK and in America, actually. But you can use the code word, WORD, that's W-O-R-D. We should have picked a different word, because code word, WORD, just sounds clunky, doesn't it?
You're not thick, you get it, WORD.
It's WORD. Time to shave those balls.
Shall I shave yours now? Adam, shall I shave yours? We'll just do that now. We'll show you. Oh, don't, you meant to flinch. Perv.
We're fucking back! And we got Laddie Dean here. What's happening?
Not much, man. Am I allowed to talk?
You're allowed to talk now, yeah. So,
I've just been told off.
Yeah, he tells us everything. So for the viewers, obviously, they all know Carl now. So Carl gets really annoyed when our guest comes in if we have any remotely humorous conversation before we start recording, because he's like, this is all for the pod.
Wasted gold. It's wasted gold. But it does feel like if you've just got out of your car, got here, that someone's going, shut up. You're funny when I say you're funny. Go. We're like, okay, good.
It's intimidating enough having that industrial estate. And also that you're the place that this is in is like, it looks like the, what's it called? The film Batman. Which one's
Dark Knight when the Joker blows up the hospital?
Yeah, yeah.
You fucking nailed it.
Aye?
It looks exactly like the college in Preston that I, thank fuck, didn't go to. But there is something else. There's that generic concrete-y feel to it.
Yeah, yeah.
And I half expect to see the Joker coming out going,
Little fun fact. Adam's fun fact. New feature. You know when the Joker presses the button and it doesn't initially work and then it blows up. Not in the script. That was meant to go off straight away. And Heath Ledger, master actor, improvised and was like, "I'll just fuck her out." And then it went off, and he was like, "Great."
Yeah. Did he just keep did he keep in character the whole time? Because that must have been an intense 3 months for everyone involved.
That's what killed him, innit? Because like he was taking pills so that he could be in the zone of the Joker, and then he couldn't get off them after the film finished.
I had the opposite though, because I had all that stuff, and then like I was, you know, when you like you watch a film now, you kind of don't really watch the film; you just Wikipedia like, yeah. for the rest. Yeah, just
not in the cinema though, please. You don't do it in the cinema.
I don't go to the cinema.
Oh, right, okay.
I can't imagine anything worse than sitting with other people you don't know watching a film.
Yeah, but you don't all have to go together. You turn up on your own.
When the credits roll, guys, let's stay together. Let's stay in contact. Let's do this every year. You can't just go, fuck you, I'm out.
You don't go to the cinema.
No, I don't like it.
I love a little solo sit. You know, like when you're gigging away. Like if I'm in London and I've got fuck all to do, or like Birmingham and you're on like, like the Glee's great. You're normally on with at least one or two sound people at the Glee. But there's some clubs that you turn up and you're like, everyone on this bill's a cunt and I'm not having lunch with any of them tomorrow. I love those days when I'm just like, I'm going to go to the cinema on my own. I like it. What do you do when you're on a cunty bill?
I do the same thing I do on a good bill. I just like stay in my hotel room and eat food all day. I don't understand why you'd have to go to the cinema. You can just download more stuff anyway.
I suppose... Yeah, I mean, it's right, but it's still kind of fun. And I know it's overpriced, but I think it's just the fact that you're doing something.
You can't download a Tango Ice Blast. That's the thing.
Also, you can't pause a film in the cinema and start masturbating. And that's usually what I do with a laptop.
That's exactly
you can't
pause
it. Can I just have 5 minutes? Popcorn going everywhere.
That's exactly the same thing I thought.
Do you pause films and then crack one out?
Totally.
Yeah, thank you, Larry.
100%.
It's great to have another fucking reprobate.
I
don't
know, but I know he does not. I
get
do
too
it.
Lost in the movie.
Oh, come
sometimes
on.
I struggle to wank to porn because I'm too invested in the story.
Has there not been films you've watched and you thought, are you now going to go, the only reason I'm watching this is because the people in the film are hot?
But porn or normal films?
not like the live action Aladdin. Not like, oh god, oh Princess Jasmine, I can show you my dick. Like, but there are some films.
No context.
That
have a word there. Like,
there are some films are sexy.
Cruel Intentions, such a sexy film, and I don't think anyone will watch it. The storyline of Cruel Intentions is not good enough for ugly people.
I haven't seen Cruel Intentions, but I get lost in a film even if they're all ugly. I think.
I'm not saying every film I watch, I'm like, half time,
Elephant
Chuck
Man.
Ice in a wank. Like, I'm not like halfway through fucking Schindler's List. I'm like, oh, she looks good in red. Like, that's such a dark reference. There's a kid in the red jacket. Sorry.
Oh, Schindler's List and wanking, the final crossover of Have a Word. That even
have
made
you ever, like, caught yourself open watching telly and then you're like, your hands are down your pants, just... fooling around, just checking it's still there, and then but something comes on the TV and you think, I should not keep my hand down my pants just in case my brain goes, oh, that's now going to be something I like. You don't want to train yourself like a dog to
that's
find that
fucking, you mean you're doing like Pavlovian dick training. I was wanking to see BBs.
Yeah, we don't like Animal just Rescue coming on, and then you got stoner. Oh,
you need to come round and see our lovely new kitten. Absolutely, you can really. Not that being a man is the worst thing. You know when we're like, it's so hard being a woman, but you can play knock a door run with your own dick. And it is real. You know, have you ever done that when you're like, I didn't mean to give myself an erection, but you've just sort of been like, whatever. And then all of a sudden you're like, are your dick's going, is it go time? You're like, no, I was just scratching.
But do you not even get the thing of like, and like when you're getting a gum test, a STD test, gum test, and when you're getting an STD
test. Where do you get your STIs? Like, come in, Larry. I'll get down here on my knees and let's see how that cum tastes.
I think there's a bit of specimen up here. You can just get a swab.
Well, no, pal, you're fucking fine. See you in 6 months.
Hey, I'm chewing jizz like tobacco. That's what it is. But you're there, and then you see all these people are like waiting to go in and get tested, and then you're like, well, they've all had sex recently. And then you just think, oh, they've all had sex recently. Oh, they've had sex recently.
They've either all had sex recently or they want you to think they've all had sex recently.
I've had the same. I've literally been in an STI clinic. Go, well, I know everybody. Fuck here. I like the. There's basically, if you're in an STI waiting room and you're not, I know that's not what it was called, but and you don't just look at the ground like the dirty cunt that you know you are. How ballsy would you have to be in an STI clinic? And be like, hey, what's up? How did you get here? Want to get here again in about 2 months?
I've got I've got a story that like it's a friend of ours, right? So a mate of mine who is in a long-term relationship, a lad, right? And he's not a cheat, he's not a rat. He was like, lad, I need to go to the STD clinic, will you come with me? And I was like, absolutely, yeah. Right, so this was a few years ago.
He took a friend?
He was just nervous.
It's like girls going to the toilet. You take your little rash and you be a fucking man and you go and have it fucking whatevered off.
He was like, there's something wrong. And I was like, I'll come with you, lads, right? So we went and I was like, it was years ago when I was single as well. I was like, I'll get tested as well. So I got called in first. And when I come out, he was just stood by the door, waiting to go. And I was like, have you been called in yet? And he went, yeah, yeah. I went, and you've been out quicker than me? Because they seemed quite quick at me. And he went, yeah, yeah. She took one look at me dick and told me to go to the hospital.
What was it?
Holy shit.
I've never asked. He's never brought it back up. We're both men. We both don't like talking about things that are serious. I hope his dick didn't fall off.
Oh, you don't like talking about, I love talking about that kind of stuff.
But how bad is it that she was like, okay, obviously it's a little, you're a bit self-aware, but you've done the right thing by coming in and let's take these pants off. Oh! And hits the button that you didn't know was there, like, you know when a bank's being robbed?
Gemma!
Are you pressing the silent alarm?
When you put your hand on the desk like that, I was like, what, with a roll of newspaper as she put a glass over it?
It's been a while since I've been to the STI. I'm out of the game. But when I lived in Manchester and I was being a dirty dog, I got to the point.
Can't.
Not like, you're all right, Gene, you're all right. Back again. Like it was getting a wee bit familiar. When you don't feel totally ashamed, you're like, I've been here.
You knew the people in the STD clinic, like I know the woman in the chippy.
Keeping me in a job. Here he is, scratchy, sending my kids to uni.
You get given numbers there.
What?
The STI clinic. Because I didn't know if this is the one that I go to. Because I've only been to two. One in London, one in Glasgow. And the one in Glasgow, for some reason, they give you a number rather than having to shout out your name.
Like it's Argos?
Yeah, it's like Argos. Oh.
Like a prisoner.
21. And
like, pervert 629. Pervert 629. Oh, fuck. Oh God!
But I actually,
just bring that mic closer to you, Larry, because you're getting so relaxed. It's
I've been driving for 4 hours, man. The guy I'm seeing right now, though, I hadn't been for a gum clinic test in months, and then he went for one, and I was like, cool. Well, that means I'm clear. It's great. So all you need to do is, if you don't want to go to an STI clinic, just get in a relationship with somebody quickly, and then they'll go and get tests. And then you've sorted yourself out.
I did that recently.
I love you so much. Plus, you took the test, so thanks for fucking...
I did that very recently with my ex-girlfriend and COVID. She went and got a test, and I was like, let's just hope I'm fine. And thank God it was negative.
Is it more of a thing within the gay scene that you've got to be a bit more aware of it? Like, is that like a weirdly, me trying to be progressive and sounding like a cunt? Or in a gay relationship, are you like, listen...
I feel like we should all turn to the camera and then the Philadelphia music comes on.
I was boozing better. Tell what I felt. I was unrecognizable to myself.
You remember the whole... Oh, nicely done.
On the streets of Glasgow. Pervert 629.
Okay, in answer to your question, I think, well, everyone's pure scared of getting the bum flu and that, so you kind of...
Bum flu?
Wow. That one didn't start in fucking China. Oh, fuck, mate.
I put it down the back of a market.
Bum flu? on the streets of...
Oh God, I can already see the hateful tweets that's gonna get.
Don't worry, we absolutely won't put that one in the clip. 10 minutes 40.
The fucking
bum flu. Oh God, she's still being so relaxed on this couch. Right?
Yeah. Oh no, all of my opinions are coming out.
I think it depends though, because like Scott Agnew did a show about HIV, really amazing show, and he started, like, because loads of people don't know about like HIV and like AIDS and stuff, and I mean, even the wording of that, AIDS and stuff, but then the fact you can have a pill now once a day and then you don't die, but then some people don't take the, it's like medicine works for most people but not everybody. So then loads of people get checked out. I mean, I remember thinking I had it 5 years ago because I had a nice night. And
you had a what?
A nice night.
A nice night.
Yes, I turned the lights off and I put a torch under my chin.
Awesome, some guys.
Oh, really? Was it like five aside nearly?
Just short of a goalkeeper. Come round, just, in and yeah, out. Yeah.
Dave, do you want to come round? We're one lad short. Are you playing five aside? Kind of.
Goalie Redness.
Yeah. Put your jackets down. But then, it was because most people get the flu apparently once they've got it, and I had the flu, but then it turned out to be glandular fever, and I got hospitalized for that instead. So I was like, oh, it's okay. It's really weird being in hospital, going, oh, thank God, it's not HIV.
Yeah. When I got chlamydia, and they just send you a letter going
chlamydia.
They send you a letter going, you've got an infection, so you want to get in contact, and we'll tell you about a treatment. So it takes all of 28 minutes for you to run as fast as you can to the fucking STI clinic. And you get there and you're like, because as soon as you've got an infection, you're like, oh, that's bum flu. That's H.
Oh, so they didn't even say chlamydia. They said
no, just they just send you a letter to freak you out. Going,
a letter?
You've got an infection.
Not a text or get a phone call. But yeah. We'll let them know in 3 working days.
Obviously, I was single a long time ago.
I remember having
King Edward's on the throne and you have bum flu.
Someone turned up with a parchment.
My dearest Daniel, I have news from the front. Y'all have an infection.
Well, yeah, exactly. You can have a police officer arrive at the door like, with his cap up like that. Like, I'm so sorry to let you know.
Dick's been in a terrible accident.
I went with another friend when he found out he got... Well, not another, look, I'm not...
Who are you? The rash guy? Fucking hell.
Look, my nickname at school was Adam the Dick Whisperer, and it's just stuck with me.
I know you know why you can't, that's covered and you can't see
it. It was amazing. It was a family member. It was a family.
Oh, now we know why your nan's dead. Adam, get me handbag. I've got a fucking rash on me flap.
It was, oh, fuck it. Do you know what? It was my little brother. And the doctor was like, you've got the clap. And that's like literally how the doctor said it. You've got the clap. And they went, what we need you to do is just get in touch with every woman you've been with since you were last tested. And my little brother, no way to lie, went to the doctor. How the fuck am I meant to do that? I don't even know their fucking names, mate.
Hi, girl with brown hair from heebie-jeebies in November 2017. I've got, how have you been? You want to just do a little bit of back and forth. How have you been? Yeah, not bad, random texter. Got some news. Things are going well with me. Rented a lovely 3-bedroom semi. And you might want to get yourself tested because the Dick Whisperer apparently raised his voice. Fucking hell.
Bye-bye now. Bye-bye, bye-bye, bye-bye.
Love.
And now
love.
This one.
I remember actually when I went for my test, the nurse says to, she goes, well, we'll text you results in 3 days' time. And then they didn't text me in 3 days' time. And I genuinely thought, I don't want to phone them because that seems a bit too keen. But then in like 7 days, he still...
Were you worried that they wouldn't want to see you again?
Yeah, that's it. I remember in a week's time after, I was like, they've still not fucking text me. And I was thinking, are they going, oh, should we text him? Nah, he's probably dead by now. Don't waste your credit on it.
And have they just forgotten to text? So he's like, if you don't get a text, you're fine.
Oh, they got the wrong number.
Right.
Because I got like a AAA.
So some poor cunt got the text. Just mid fucking bowl of cornflakes.
Imagine if his wife seeing it. What the fuck is this, Barry? Where have you been? It says you've got knob rot.
I'm on my fucking honeymoon and I get a text with my new fucking wife. You've got knob rot. I haven't even been to Glasgow STI clinic.
Oh, fuck me.
I heard, and forgive me if this is, obviously I'm a straight man.
In a pink hoodie, obviously.
I am a straight man. Yeah, I heard, right. And you, I just want, we haven't had one of your lot in yet, so... I was just going to use you.
Jesus Christ.
Disinfect the couch while I'm going.
One of your lot. Thanks for filling a quota, Larry.
I know, that's what I said. Saturday when they walk up the stairs, I said, this is the first podcast I've been on that's two straight white men. I'm quite nervous about it.
Well, the BBC refused to commission it, so we made it ourselves. just gotta ask. I heard a rumor a while back, I think it was an article on Facebook or something, that sometimes gay people have an AIDS orgy and one person's got AIDS and the rest of them just haven't and they all just fuck it. It's like Russian roulette. Is that true?
Yeah, that's true.
Oh my God, I thought it was gonna be bullshit.
Why?
Is it definitely true?
Yeah, some people, they're called AIDS chasers.
AIDS chasers?
Yeah, yeah.
Like it's a fucking Jaeger bomb on the side of a fucking Guinness.
That's another show the BBC didn't
want
to take.
I want a pint of cock with an AIDS chaser. Thank you very much.
Just the chaser comes out. It's a really skinny guy.
And Paul Sinnoh's just on it anyway. Oh, two. Shit, sorry.
Sorry. Sorry. I already apologise. Oh God, but I want to keep it in.
Oh. Well, I can't.
Oh.
I know we say this a lot, but this is the one that ruins it.
I didn't filter that. That thought was just already coming out. Oh God! Hercules, Hercules, Hercules!
What are we talking about?
I don't know.
So, Larry, when you go to Tesco, what meal deal do you get?
Preference in sandwich. Tuna mayo guy.
Oh God!
Have you been gigging much? Are you back? Is this your first foray?
How are you trying to just?
I'm trying. To get it back on the rails.
You just crashed your car into a tree and then gone, oh, I didn't indicate, actually.
Yeah, I'm literally on the road and two of the wheels are like, flap, flap, flap. No, it's fine. I'm just going to drive home.
Oh, my God. You just run over my family and then just gone, you have to match this weekend?
Yeah.
So, I've been gigging. I'm trying as well. I'm getting on this little train track with you. I have been gigging a bit, yeah. Done like a few gigs down in London, and then
You're really trying to get. Welcome back to the road. Come on, you can do it.
You've made Larry Dean do an impression of Edvard Munch's scream. The fuck was that?
It was Edvard Munch.
What was well timed? That fucking art, like, oh yeah, let me just do an art reference.
Well, I'm really into art. I don't know whether
you
told you. Yeah,
we did that in school. That's why
we did. Yeah, I know. Escher does the stairs as well.
Yeah.
Escher paintings with the stairs.
I love Escher.
Yeah, I know that from a battle rap reference.
Escher Akbar. Yeah.
Escher Akbar, yeah.
Eshan's sister. Yeah, I know her, yeah.
I know Neil Buchanan from Art Attack.
Yeah, there you go. Banksy. Yeah, because it's good, because you don't have to go inside for it. It's just outside, you walk past.
I do prefer graffiti to framed art.
Yeah.
You're good at drawing, though. Like,
am I good at drawing?
Yeah.
He thinks
absolutely.
He is.
What do you want?
I don't know. Draw it down.
Don't. Because it's nice big round head. You an art guy, Larry? Are you like a secret culture vulture?
But I don't know that much. I did a higher art, it was like your guys' A levels and that.
Oh, right,
I can't even really draw anymore. But then I felt a bit like loads of pricks got into that and like lockdown and that. I'm like, oh, I'm going to rediscover. Not only like some of them are actually good, but then you know when people kind of go, well,
Yeah, it's good, isn't it?
It's beautiful.
Considering how quick I've done it, though, it's not too bad.
Yeah, it's really good. Larry, he thinks he's good at everything.
But I think I'm good at the things I think I'm good at.
But that's a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
What do you think you're bad at, then?
I can't skip.
Right. I mean, imagine that. It's like the first thing that comes to mind. What's what you're bad at? Skipping.
He is. That's more vulnerability than he's shown.
Being a straight man.
So obviously. We want to take him round an art gallery. That's really what we want to do because he got so wound up about.
Because Dan's a fucking art shagger. So
no, like, I'm not. I'm not particularly. I just like that. I like some modern art.
Yeah.
And well, you think it's got to be on a wall and a picture of something, otherwise it's shit.
No, I don't. I just think some of it people are pretending to like and pretend is good because other people have gone, isn't that good? It's like at the Edinburgh Festival when you go and see one of the hype shows and everyone's like, it's so life-changing. You go and it's just someone fucking whinging that the nan's dead for an hour. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? You're like, come on.
Nanette.
No, what's not that. Nanette is wonderful. It is.
We were talking about Tracy Emin's bed.
You know the bed thing?
You know my bed? That's just
the unmade
messy,
bed art
The messy
thing.
Bed.
No. He's going to be on my go. Side here and I can't fucking wait for this. So, some woman, right?
Some woman.
Tracy Emin.
Tracy Emin.
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 Yes.
Tracy Emin, right?
Did she win the Turner Prize for it?
She did.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because they're all just part of a fucking circle jerk. Do you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Back to the Edinburgh Comedy Awards.
Exactly, right? So... So she was commissioned to do like this
installation
like an art thing,
right.
And like a couple of days before she was like, fuck it, I haven't done that painting, right? So she looked at her bedroom and went, my room's a mess, this is the best representation of my life at the minute. So she in the art gallery just put a fucking messy bedroom.
She's
and everyone
bed.
Was like, oh my God, isn't it so thoughtful? I was like,
was
no, she's a lazy twat.
Tissues and fucking horrible. She was like, this sums up the fuck up that is my life at the moment. And she remade it in, they were expecting like a sculpture of some sort.
And she gave them a fucking hangover.
And she gave them a messy bed. And it kicked off because people were like, it's not art. Just did a row and went, it's so disgusting. Wash your sheets. And then some mums tried to tidy the bedroom and make the bed for her. And then other people went, it's brilliant because it's so original and different. It's daring.
Oh, it's shit.
Yeah, yeah. Okay,
utter
cool.
Shit.
Hank, it's that fucking Christ.
It's that thing if anyone could do it, then it's like, you can look at, I mean, all this, oh, well, even like the Super Mario thing behind you, I'm like, not everyone can draw that picture. So that deserves to win it more than an unmade bed.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I make that every morning.
This is, I'm turning that off. Could you imagine if someone put in the Super Mario 3 poster for the Turner fucking prize?
But that is better than what she did.
No, it's a poster for a computer game.
But someone drew that and meant to.
Oh yeah, it's really iconic graphic design.
More effort went into that than what went into
it. It's not modern art, it's a computer game cover.
No. Yeah, but someone put the effort in, drew that and was like, what colour should we make his art? Red.
But you don't think games can even be art?
So if it's harder to physically do, it's better.
Yes.
Yeah,
so one amazing bit of original skill from Sadio Mane in a football game is not as good as some fucking lump playing for Leighton Orient who's run around the pitch for like fucking 90 minutes just putting a shift in. It's not about, it's about the stroke of genius, isn't it?
But you've got like literally the original bit of skill that Sadio Mane does is harder to do than run around a pitch for 90 minutes.
Tracy Emin's bed.
No.
No, it's not physically as hard, is it? That's harder to do because you've got to take ages with it. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's physically harder to run around and do a fucking shift, but it's still those moments of brilliance might actually physically not take anything. Like it might take nothing and it happens and you go, fuck me, that's special.
No, you've got it the wrong way around.
No, I agree, Dan.
Of course you do, because you're a fucking linguist or a linguini or whatever you're.
Yeah, you've watched too much Ratatouille. What you say? Right, you're coming to the art gallery when I take this fucking lid round.
I'm going to be staying in my hotel room eating food and wanking in between films. So yeah. Busy, mate.
Yeah, if we can't get him to a cinema, he's not going to be like, oh, fucking hell, boys. Yeah. I've just had a KFC and crack 1A. Let's go to the fucking portrait gallery.
Oh, this is him. So we've known each other. I was thinking about this because you were on the way here. I was like, what can we talk to that about? I think, correct me if I'm wrong, did I give you your first ever paid gig?
30 quid Casa Comedy. Thank you very much.
I did. Isn't that nice?
That's cute.
So I ran a gig.
You're making dreams come true.
I started this kid. I gave him his first break in the business. 30 quid and he had to drive from fucking Southampton to Liverpool for it. So it was still a negative equity gig. It was when we first started out. And I ran a gig called Casa Comedy at the Casa in Liverpool.
You've told us.
The little Dockers pub in the back room.
Yeah.
And I'd done Beat the Frog a couple of times.
I remember you starting out at Beat the Frog.
Well, you did like a fence.
Coming down to Preston a few times.
Yeah.
I remember you did my first gong show.
Yeah.
It's the circle of life.
As a straight man.
But you were quite like offensive sort of jokes at the time, weren't you?
Mine, I know. I still cringe about all that.
Do you really?
Yeah, I hate it because I was like, I hate that thing of, you know, when you even see people do it now of like trying to be like really offensive or like trying to, just for the sake of it. It's like, I mean that comment earlier, Dan, but it's the difference between like being silly and just being offensive for the hell of it. It's like you can be offensive and silly, and I think that's all right because it's you just taking it to a complete kind of, this is ridiculous, of course I'm not a paedophile, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But then it's but the other side that I was doing, I was like, oh, it's just shit.
Because is that because you got like a style that you wanted to do but you hadn't? It's almost like trying to run before you can walk, isn't it? People start and they're like, I'm a Bill Hicks fan. I like Doug Stanhope. Abortion. You're like, no. Yeah, you need at least 15 gigs under your belt before we open a set with, so, abortion.
But like, it was effective, wasn't it? Like, you were like winning those gong shows.
But it's because it was one-liners.
Yeah.
And some people were going on and talking about like how funny their dog was. So it's not like, but
you had a better hit rate.
Yeah, but it was even that thing of like, even if you didn't like it, it still got a reaction.
Yeah.
Which I think that's kind of half of the reason why I did it, because I thought, well, at least if I die in my arse, I'll get a reaction.
You'd rather get booed than silence.
Totally. Any day.
Just make some noise.
That happens a lot at Beat the Frog. That you don't, rather than playing to like, because doing everyday stuff and making it funny is quite difficult. Mm. Like almost mainstreaming, like it's not offensive, it doesn't get a shock, it doesn't get a reaction. To make that funny is quite difficult. It can be a bit bland if you've watched a lot of stand-up. For a crowd, if you do abortion, rape, like paedophilia, even though it's crass, at least it gets a response. Mm. Like a crowd will, just through the shock of it, go, oh! And to a lot of new comics, they thrive on that because at least it's not just like, meh.
Yeah. And even it's clearer to know where the punchline is as well if you're not used to like making jokes up. You kind of go, oh, cool. Well, the big reveal is that turned out he was like a pedo the whole time or whatever like that, rather than like, I don't know. You know those jokes that I think most people's favourite jokes that they've ever made are the ones that they've accidentally just come up with on the spot on stage. It's like your brain's just gone, oh, God, here's the joke you've been looking for months for that bit. And that becomes your favourite joke because there's no kind of like logical reason why it works or why it's funny.
It's happened naturally.
Yeah. But with the offensive stuff, it's like you don't have to bother with even going through that process of naturally getting good at it.
I remember, so I'd done Beat the Frog a few times and you were on like three of the four that I did and just like dead good. And I was like, will you come and do my gig? So we were running a gong show at the Casa. And I was like, we need to get an opener and we'll pay them like 30 quid. So I asked Laddie and like new comic. Like I didn't know what I was fucking doing. But I was like, 30 quid, come and do the gig. And you smashed it to bits because such a lovely support. It was all my friends and family, but you made my cousin cry. Because you did like a dead baby joke, right? Oh, and like at one point in her life, she lost the baby. So she left like really upset. And I'm in the, but this shows that I'm more of a comic even at that stage than a family person. Because she was like, he cannot joke about dead babies because he doesn't know what it's like to lose. And I was like, listen, just because you've lost a baby doesn't mean it's not funny. You're allowed to not like it, but he can still make the joke.
Ideally, you never have to have that conversation.
I did not know, and I regret doing that. Fucking hell.
This is why we got you on.
Eight years isn't that long ago.
This is why we got you on. We've got some fucking questions. You should never have to have the conversation. Like, ideally, all comics should never have to have that justifying a joke conversation ever, should they? They should just like be on stage, it go badly, and if it goes badly with everyone, you just have to like take the loss and go out the fire exit.
Yeah.
Like you should, when you have to walk out and someone goes, excuse me, and you're like, oh, here's the worst 5 minutes of my year. It's even I lost the fucking bit.
Yeah, then corporate, so when they like, or like, for some reason, I have no idea why, a couple of years ago, this company booked me for like a builder's gig. And I was like, of all the comics that you would book, for builders. You pick this goony fucking gay guy.
Where?
I'm like, Birmingham as well. It's like just
an away day. Yeah, yeah. It's not even like Glaswegian. We're like, oh, right, he's a bummer, but at least he's one of ours.
Yeah. Right, it's like literally nothing. They've got nothing in common with these people. And then the guy was, one of the guys who was there was like, oh, you don't do any dirty jokes, like sex jokes, because there's a couple of ladies in tonight. And I was like, that's one thing I always think is why people get offended at sex stuff, because I'm like, well, everybody does it. So I don't understand why that's considered a dirty comic, somebody talking about sex. Also, that was the stuff I ended up doing. That was fucking...
Because they're builders.
Aye.
Also, do you think women that work in the building trade are fucking Victorian ladies?
Yeah, like, you can't mention sex, but like a builder can go, hey, love, look at your tits! Yeah, yeah, exactly. That's fine, apparently. Hey, women!
Isn't it weird?
Do you want to see me knob?
How those guys think they're being gentlemen, and actually they're being the worst old-style douchebag, like sexist. Like, oh, listen, Larry, I know you're a comedian, you know you. And obviously we're 98% working-class builders from the West Midlands, but as there's three ladies in, please don't say fuck cunt or talk about flaps. Their pretty little feminine minds will probably pop. They might start menstruating, and no one wants that at the corporate gig. Like, oh, fuck off, you knobhead. Like, they work in the building train. They can take a joke.
A toilet.
And a dick.
This is becoming... So this bell is meant to be the bullshit bell. When I'm obviously talking shit, right, trying to wind Dan up, it does that. But it's also becoming the yellow card bell for you.
Is it?
When yeah. You, hang on. Check yourself.
Okay, good. Well, wait. Thought, where were you about 20 minutes
ago?
Just
to indicate an editing point. Cut that bit.
Oh, we don't cut anything out here, do we?
Oh, God. Maybe the dead baby story might be worth a cut. Don't want that haunting me again. Don't shake your head.
Oh my God.
It's a ghost.
I just pressed the thing. Oh, the dead baby's here. I mean, a lot of people would say I just pressed the chair thing with my leg, but actually I think it's haunted.
I made a worse joke than anything you said, even when you were doing that type of stuff back then, and it was so fucking shit. So, and I'll tell you it, and it literally trumps, like, if anyone gets in trouble for this episode, it will be me for this, because it was... So it was the week after Michael Jackson had died, and the joke I told was, I read on the news today, you know, because everyone was buying his albums and stuff, because he died. I said, I read on the news today that Michael Jackson's made over $300 million since he died as a babysitter for Kate McCann and Lily Allen. See that reaction? See that reaction? That's what the Frog and Bucket, Hot Water Comedy Club, and everywhere else I did the exact same thing, just like, we're not ready for that.
Is it weird telling that joke without seeing people put cards up?
Do you know, the amazing thing was, you have literally put that information back into the world. Like, you could have literally got to the end of it. Yeah, Larry, back then you really did take too many risks.
Team, so that if anyone gets in trouble from our show, it's me and not
thank
him.
Thank you, mate.
You just, I think people enjoy the honesty of the pod. We've said that before. But
and also, I don't think it's funny. I don't still do it now.
No.
I was 18 and fucking stupid.
Yeah.
This is the thing though as well though, when you look back, like, because I was thinking that 10 years ago, that's when we started, and then you're like, fucking hell. But also, even thinking that's when... like Frankie Boyle and stuff was on Mock the Week, and then I think loads of comics were really offensive then because he saw that it was working.
Oh, Frankie Boyle spawned so many like Harvey Price jokes from open spots, and now like I host a lot of new act nights, so I host a lot of Hot Water. I do Beat the Frog like once every 8 weeks or whatever, and there are so many James A. Caster impersonations.
Oh my God, I was literally gonna go James A. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, so I'm 22, I'm at university, and I hate my flatmate.
Yeah, the rhythm of it.
Yeah, yeah, it's like just the talking to the side, like I'm awkward, but I'm funny. It's really, you've watched every one of his specials 1,000 times.
Mate, there are professional comics who I have seen in the last 12 months, pre-Rona, and I'm like going, you didn't talk like this the last time we worked together. Younger men who've clearly gone, oh, I kind of like the rhythm of that.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's there's still a lot of Bill Hicks now, because obviously he's so revered. Like, there's like one a year with them, like at the new act night, they go on. They often wear like a suit jacket, with like a comic book t-shirt on and baggy jeans and shit shoes, and they're just like
Stuart Lee as well. Stuart Lee, yeah. Stuart Lee
had them for a while, yeah.
Just copy comics and no one's heard of.
Yeah.
That's great.
The bigger face.
You're a big Patrice O'Neill fan originally.
Oh, mate, I'd love to do Richard Pryor or Chris Rock for like, you know, I could do a Chris Rock or something. The difference between gay people and faggots. And faggots have got to go.
No, but do it in your Glaswegian accent, like you're...
I should mind. I'm doing Kevin Bridges for some reason.
Do what I do every time.
Oh, please do the whole routine, man.
What is Kevin Bridges?
However you want to do it. Your voice, his, Billy Connolly's, the other one.
Bridges doing Chris Rock.
Good difference between... difference between... I feel weird that I'd be told talk like yourself.
No, sorry.
How do I talk?
The difference between gay people and faggots have gotta go.
I've gotta go. Fucking hell, man.
Mate, can I just say, next time you're doing those builders gigs in Birmingham, open with that. My God, fucking quality. Fucking quality.
I just realized as well, I've said the F word. Adam, can you tell another joke you used to tell?
Yeah, yeah. Take another for the team.
So,
we're going to have an interval now, and shall we have a little break?
Yeah, and we've done 37 minutes, and I hope you enjoyed all 14 that we were allowed to put out.
Oh, gee.
See you in a sec. What's happening, guys? If you love this podcast and you really want to support us, you can go to haveawordpod.com. You can get yourself some merch, something like this hoodie, something like that t-shirt. There's plenty of stuff for you to go and have a look at there. There's also links so you can buy tickets to the Have a Word live shows and also tickets to mine and Dan's tour shows if you want to come and see us do stand-up. That's all at haveawordpod.com.
We also do an extra episode of the podcast every week on patreon.com/haveawordpod. Sign up on Patreon, get the exclusive Patreon episode. There's also some discounts on merch, discount on live tickets, but the extra episode is only on Patreon. That's patreon.com/haveawordpod.
Bye, Felicia.
Bye.
What have we got? We've got some questions and some features and shit.
Just waiting for Larry to be ready. He's just having
nice
a little...
Nice and ready.
Oh my God,
he's ready. Hey, you got some questions for me? You tell me the questions.
Who was that meant to be? Is that like Al Pacino just, after he spent time in Aberdeen?
I just say, listen, son, you got some questions for me?
He's got an accent.
I do the accent.
What do you mean? That's just a Scottish accent. You already got one.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
That's like me going, all right, lad, let's have a fucking question. And you're like, oh, my God.
It was older.
So
it was
gone.
Older.
I can do, was it cool? I can do voices and that.
Can you?
Yeah.
Can you really?
Have them. Come on.
I can do voices.
We can't say that.
How well?
Not amazing. I don't know what's going on there.
You're backing
it depends what it is. It depends.
So one of these is an accent, one of these is a job, and one of these is an emotion. So you are a hungover.
Northern Irish. Horse bumhole cleaner.
Horse bumhole cleaner.
Honestly, that's totally true. That's horse bumhole cleaner.
So what am I supposed to do with that?
Okay, so imagine
what
this
is
like why, an audition.
Is that not enough range? Like, what
happened yesterday?
You want more context? Happy to oblige. So you are a hungover and you can do whatever happened yesterday is yours to improvise. You're from Northern Ireland and you are about to clean a horse's bumhole, which you know how to do. And I've interrupted you because I would like you to clean my cow's bumhole. Okay, so let's imagine this is an audition. You're auditioning for a role, big Hollywood movie. You're going to be a star. You're going to be a star kid. Okay, so ready? You ready? You ready to improvise? Let's just go for it. Hiya, mate. Listen, I know you're busy with that horse over there, but I've got a cow's cavity that needs fucking scrubbing over here.
I ain't quite busy at the moment.
Oh, Freddie fucking Quinn.
Answer it!
Fucking
shit. Sorry, guys. Sorry.
Freddie Quinn now? I don't know. That's Republic of Ireland. I moved from the north to the Republic quite young. That's... So, I'm not going to do this. I'm going to do the southern one. So
that's quite good, actually. I like that.
Oh, thank you. Oh, nice man over there. Come on now. So you need me to clean your toilet, as you said.
No, not my toilet, lads. I've got a fucking cow over here, and he's fucking clogged well up. I got told by the guys down the road that you do horse bumholes, and he was like, you might take a look at me cow if I brought it along.
Horses bumholes, nothing like a cow's, to be fair. I mean, what's his name? I don't want to go near the back of it if I don't know its name first. You know what I'm saying?
Kevin the cow.
God.
What's the horse's name?
My wife. I call her darling.
Fucking hell. We've made these so hard. It's unbelievable. We were setting it up, do you remember when we first did it? It was just literally like Congolese fishermen. And now it's like, you are grieving. You're grieving. And you are from Peru. You know, not Chile. Make the distinction.
He said, problem as well, like you go to the Northern Irish accent. I was thinking, I don't know how I'm going to talk about cleaning his bum without going, get out now.
You got 3 minutes to clean the horse's arsehole.
Some of the accents I try and learn, though, I'm like, there's certain places you can go that don't want you to impersonate their accent. I cannot do a Scouse accent because it's trial and error. And if you go on stage in Liverpool and try and do their accent,
they don't like it.
You better be fucking sure.
You better be good. If you can do a good Scouse accent, like we had Alfie Brown in last week. Alfie's Scouse accent is fucking no perfect. Like he could get away with sounding like he's from fucking Dovecot, where I'm from.
Yeah.
But like it's the overemphasized K's and like the hack. I was some chicken and a can of Coke. No one fucking talks like that. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So, but I want some chicken and a can of Coke.
Going to the Northeast, Teesside, when you want to do the voice and then you just end up doing Geordie and they're like, that's not how we talk. And you're
how
like,
we, man? You sound exactly the same.
And then they're getting pissed off because to you, it doesn't sound much different, but that is a horrific attempt at a Teesside accent.
Yeah, it's like when I gig with someone from like Ormskirk, and then someone's like, you're both Scousers, and I'm like,
yeah.
No!
Do you know all the ones that you think are going to be West Country, like Ipswich, or anywhere around East Anglia, or Shropshire, it's tempting to be, all right, I'm from Virgin, and
for Ipswich, isn't that like near Norwich?
Yeah, East Anglia.
But that's not West Country, is it? It's East Country.
That is literally what I'm saying.
Oh, right, okay.
But when you do East Anglian, it is a bit like Ipswich and fucking Norfolk.
Mm.
But to me, that sounds like the West Country. It all sounds a bit farmery, but try and do it, and they're like, what the fuck was that?
Exactly. I can do the only Northern, because loads of places in the North don't like you impersonating the accent, because even like Newcastle and Sunderland have slightly different accents.
Yeah.
So it's difficult to get a bang on. The northeastern one, like the Yorkshire one, is easier to know because it tends to be a bit more like generic.
Can I stop you there? I found that really offensive, Larry, actually.
You want a cup of tea then?
As a northerner. It's actually really good. And also, no one's going to be like, in the north, like, that is absolutely disgusting. You're doing a Blackburn impression and I'm actually from Darwin. Like, no one gives a fuck.
Can you do Scouse though?
No, I tell you what, I've been able to do it a tiny bit if I've spent enough time there. Like, if I'm there for a week, by the end of the week, and I wouldn't say it was like like Alfie Brown's impression, like 10 out of 10, mine would be like, probably about a fucking 6 out of 10. It'd be like, some words you'd be like, you could get away with saying yes and no, Larry, in a taxi, but I would never be able to have a conversation as it.
Can you just try it for me? I want you to say, take me to the bombed out church.
Take me to the bombed out church.
Yeah, no, really.
It's not.
What did I get fucked there?
Church. That was
bad. Oh, yeah. It's,
that wasn't bad.
Yeah.
Can you try that?
Take me to the bombed out church.
Not too bad. He's getting better. He's spending too much time.
I wonder fucking why. It's almost like I've had some fucking chance to study the accent with him going, you're a fucking nonce. You're a rat.
You learn in your bubble, don't you?
Oh, my God.
Ooh, Jesus.
We've had some questions in. Colin Pugh says, now, in the first section, we were... What?
Is this going out live?
What do you mean?
How is the questions coming in?
No, we've got this thing now. It's called an email.
No, but then how are they messaging questions? Fucking shot myself. I was like,
they're not messaging questions from what we've done so far.
Oh, okay, cool.
We've got an angry email here. Man.
I was thinking, oh no, fucking dead babies. I need to make sure I posted something before that to show I'm a good person.
Really angry email here from someone called Paul.
Let me know before this goes out so I can like post about how I planted trees this week. It's not all bad.
I'll tell you right now, because if you are a little bit anxious that I told everyone you made a dead baby joke 10 years ago, just let me put your mind at ease. And even with what he said about the chase, which is absolutely staying in and he gets no choice in that.
Love you, Paul. It's a friend of mine.
But he would love that joke anyway. In the grand scheme of the... How many episodes is it? Is this 87?
Oh, we're well up there.
Right. I reckon this is in the bottom 20 for being inappropriate.
Oh, cool.
So you're absolutely fine.
Thank God you said for being inappropriate.
Step up your game, laddie.
Was that?
Step up your game.
No, man. I'm just a bit late. I was just going to think, oh, don't worry, Larry. No one's going to listen to this episode anyway.
We went so far with Alfie Brown that we just put the whole episode behind a paywall.
Yeah.
And this is nowhere near that.
How offensive was that, Scouse accent?
It's what he said.
If you want to join the paywall, by the way, it's patreon.com/haveawordpod. You get an extra episode every week and you get early access to these public fuck arounds. Get on board.
Yeah, and all the old ones as well. Someone asked about that. It's all the old Patreon episodes as well. Yep. Liam Witterick says, a Scally in Concert Square.
Yes.
That's town, is it? Liverpool.
It's right in the middle of town, yeah.
Is that the one where we watched Watford get absolutely annihilated in the FA Cup final?
McCooley's Concert Square we were, yeah.
I follow Watford. Oh my God, I'm so old. And went to a pub in Liverpool on FA Cup final day. Man City beat us what felt like 23-1, nil. And I honestly kept getting looks from Scousers like, fucking hell, lad. Like, really? Jesus Christ. Like,
why Watford?
Well, just sort of got into it. I wasn't into football when I was a kid. My dad was a Formula One guy.
Right.
And I got to school. What?
And Dan couldn't drive.
Yeah, that's not how Formula One works. You can't follow Formula One. Where's your license? And I got to school and I had one geeky mate and we tried to be all like weird and geeky and support a team that no one else supported. And I really enjoyed the process. Everyone was like, United, Blackburn Rovers. And we were like, fucking Watford. And everyone hated it, but had nothing to hate us for.
Aye.
Because we were a lower league team from the fucking South.
But then do you have like a preference in of another, like, do you have another team that, like, you know, like the way Scottish people have an English team? Do you have like anything like, as in like you would go, well, in the top part of the league?
Purely. Because it makes me more buoyant on the podcast. His second team is probably Liverpool now because it leads to better episodes. Right,
okay. I honestly don't actually give a shit about Liverpool FC that much. But when they're winning leagues, he's fucking great fun. So if we could go on a 20-year dominant, oh yeah, and we've got like a Carabao Cup for Carl, keep him happy. Just one Carabao Cup, keep him happy. I mean, it'll be a big improvement.
Can I just a little side note, because I don't think you've mentioned before that your dad was a Formula One guy, and if you did, I didn't really pick you up on it. Why is that fun for anyone? I just don't get, and it's gone, I just don't.
Yeah, I mean, well, if that's what you boil it down to, doesn't sound great, does it? But it is, like, if you know Formula One, you know the backstory, you know the teams, you know the drivers, and you know after a while how difficult it is to overtake or whatever, it is quite entertaining, but it's not an easy sport. What do they call it? Like, as a tourist, if you just fucking flick it on. And I think that's why football, our football, is the most popular sport, because even your mum gets it.
Yeah.
There's a ball, don't touch it with your hands, kick it over there. When it's in that net, Maureen, when it's in the net, it's a goal. One goal is 1 point. Like, it's not complicated, is it? Try explaining rugby union to someone who doesn't get it. Because it's fucking complicated.
Shite.
It's a kick for points, but if you kick it there, that's different points. And if you score it there, but you can't, and then you can't pass it forward, it's complicated. And then sometimes they just have a big muddy cuddle. Like, it's weird, isn't it? But Formula One's the same. If you don't know, you're just seeing cars going, wow. But if you're into it, it's pretty fucking entertaining. I've lost it a bit.
But it's like the pit stop, though. That's when I kind of go, wow, look how amazingly quick the mechanics are. But I'm like, imagine like football.
Is that
the
why
best
you
bit. Want? But imagine like football, the best bit of it was the substitutions. You know what I mean? It's like, it's, yeah. I'm thinking, I'm not even caring about the, like.
I don't know anyone who's ever said that to me. Like, my favourite bit is the pit stop.
It's
because
brilliant.
I've actually worked minimum wage in a Quick Fit. And I really respect what those guys can do. Do you know, he just came in for fuel. And
and an MOT. That's a really interesting viewpoint.
They change wheels so fast.
I've been to Formula One races, like at the track, a few times, and I tell you what, that is some of the ugliest fucking punter you will see at sport. Like, it's just a load of fucking dads who like cars, an occasional gremlin that someone's calling his wife. It is not a good-looking bunch. Like, I love Formula One, and everyone's got their, like, little teams kit, loads of umbrellas.
They have kits. They have kits. Like, I've got a Ferrari kit. Really?
P.S. Anyone wearing a Ferrari kit is a cunt or a child or Polish.
What nationality? The McLaren country?
Oh, McLaren's a sound. McLaren supporters are sound. It's a bit British. It's
and what about Red Bull?
A bit young, a bit poncy, fine. Because it's a bit cooler, you know.
Feels like a car would support that.
That'd be Mercedes.
Yeah, Mercedes is now like the... If you're English, that will probably be who you support because of Lewis Hamilton.
Isn't he McLaren?
McLaren's like... No, he used to be McLaren. Now he's Mercedes. McLaren's like, because they've got Lando Norris. I know more about this than I'd actually like.
So do they do transfers like footy?
They're just free contracts. They don't buy you. They just get to an end of a contract and like, will you move here? We'll give you a fuck ton of money. They do a load of Bosman frees, basically.
Right, okay.
Ferrari is never that. Although they're like a prestige name, you see someone in Ferrari and you're like, nah, you fucking knob.
Where was Michael Schumacher? Was he Ferrari? Yeah.
He was a Benetton, then Ferrari, then Mercedes.
Sweet. I only know him and Lewis Hamilton.
And then you get the occasional bell end who's like a hipster who's like, actually, I really like Force India and I've still got the mechanics top from Force India 2018. And you know he's a bell end.
So when you say a kit though, is it like footy kit? Or you're looking at me like I'm a dickhead.
Do you think what, they got shorts and socks?
Just merch, innit?
It's just like the...
So the jacket.
It's like Mercedes.
And like, yeah. And like, do they have kecks?
Yeah, you can't. I mean,
so you can wear what Lewis Hamilton wears, basically.
No, because that's
the. Do they have an away version,
mate? That's the jumpsuit. Then you look a real bellend.
Well, can you buy the jumpsuits?
You can. They're about £250. If you honestly, as a grown man, were walking around Silverstone, round the stadium with the full Mercedes jumpsuit and the Puma like racing boots and a helmet, you better be wearing the helmet because someone's going to punch you in the back of the head because you're a fucking bellend.
I just don't see the point. I only really got into the NFL because I like the fucking costumes and that, do you know what I mean?
It's just, you know, it's what people... When I used to go when I was a kid, people just gave out cigarettes because it was back in the day where Formula One...
Even to you. Yeah, kid. It's different here.
Is it mainly men that are in the stands?
Mainly. Few trolls.
I was even wondering, like, few trolls. So I get, like, why women and men are separated for, like, football and, like, rugby and, like, tennis and stuff because of, like, the size of muscles and the physical thing. But what's that got... Could they not have female...
Yeah.
Formula One.
You mean just put them all in?
Yeah.
Like have the women compete with the men? Yeah. I always think about that with darts. Why are women worse at darts?
They're worse at nearly every sport physically, aren't they?
But what about, like, darts is so fucking...
Was it not the question I was asking?
No.
I just flipped it into, like...
Do you know...
Like,
I don't know,
I'm actually asking, though. What is it about this? What have men got?
Hand-eye coordination.
All right.
So does that mean we're...
You made it a hate crime then.
Yeah.
So we are better at driving.
Formula One is not the men's Formula One. It's Formula One. There just aren't any women better than the men.
Right.
So there's no women's version of Formula One?
No, there's Formula One. That's for women as well.
But they just don't qualify.
They're just not good enough. There's been a couple of Formula One drivers. There's a woman...
Trying to take the heat off me now.
No, I'm just... They're just not... I'm not even trying to do, hey, he's bloody driving, lads. Thank fuck it's not Formula One parking. You know what I'm saying.
When you say they're not good enough, have they tried? Has there ever been a woman who's come along and been like, I'm fucking getting involved, me?
Well, there's been a few female test drivers. One lost her eye, and this is not funny, about 5 years ago. One...
Don't ever say it's not funny before saying a story.
Oh, no. I really wish I'd not said this, because I know he's gone. But she drove into a truck.
What was the truck doing on the Formula One track?
No, it wasn't on the Formula One.
Test driver, you soft twat.
She basically lost control. It's not funny. She's fucking.
Fucking when the M6 goes down to one lane, she's just stuck behind it in a fucking Ferrari. Get out the. Why are you passing him on the right? She threw 61. You stupid cunt. Get out of me. Where she's trying to go through the middle. Eyes gone.
Did you think this? Do you think like Formula One's gone a bit weird? It's just racing. We're going to make it more like driving. We're going to have roadworks and a diversion at turn three. You're going to fuck off around a local council estate, and we're going to have kids running over the start and finish line just to make it realistic.
But you said there's a female driver
not on the track.
But you didn't say that.
I know.
You just said she hit a truck.
She hit a truck coming back from testing. And she's like, it took her eye out.
Was she driving a Formula One car when she did it, or was she in like a fucking Ford Focus?
No, she was in a Formula One car. Yeah.
Was she in a Formula One car and had the ability to hit a truck? You can't drive a Formula One car on the motorway, can you?
No, I think it was it was off the track.
Right.
And I think, as much as I know, I mean, it was a bad incident.
Why was there a truck there? What do you need a truck for at a Formula One track?
Loading the car on and off. I think it comes in a truck.
That doesn't make any sense.
Yes, they don't drive it from the garage, do they? Hey, right, lads, Formula One race this weekend. Get a good ring up Ferrari. Tell them to drive to fucking Germany over the Alps in the Formula One car. They do load them up and then unload them.
But how many can you get in a truck?
It's not... Jesus Christ. I love that I know exactly what your reasoning is on all of this. Like, I get why you think like that, but there's not like, there's just, I think it's one a truck.
One a truck.
Have you seen cars?
How fucking with economically inefficient is that to be like, we've got to get this car over there, put it in a truck and drive the truck?
Yeah, I think that's not the only problem with economic efficiency and like pollution with the Formula One.
No, but it is a problem, isn't it?
I think it might.
It's like the easiest thing to solve. Just drive the fucking car.
Yeah. What about when they're Australia? Like,
well, they're not driving the fucking truck when it's into Australia as well, are they?
They put it on a plane.
Well, but they put the truck on, they put the car in the truck and then the truck on the plane. What honestly, are you talking about? You look at me sometimes like I'm a fucking dickhead and then you say that.
But you're looking at me like they drive each individual Formula One car through fucking Papua New Guinea, get a ferry. Like, fucking hell, boys. We only have one race every 5 years, but this Australian Grand Prix is worth the wait.
But I don't really see the need for the truck. It's already a car.
Oh, God. What if there's a speed bump?
That's like driving the ambulance into the hospital, but leaving you in the ambulance.
But then also, if the car...
Hi, Larry. Welcome back. This is your episode.
I actually thought I'll just spark this up because I'm going to be waiting a while. But yeah, the speed bumps, also the fact that if you crash it, apparently it's going to take an eye out. But then also... If you crash it in a normal car, there's like a crumple zone, but in a Formula One car, there's not, so they wouldn't meet the safety standards to actually...
Oh, the fucking Microsoft paperclip here. Fucking oh, well, actually, I've got the actual answer. We don't want that, okay? We want absolute speculation and nothing else.
You want a Formula One car that is literally testing the limits of what a motorised vehicle can do, can also pass a fucking MOT and be road safe? What's the point of the Formula One if it can't go to Tesco and back?
Actually, isn't the thing, how fast can Formula One cars go?
220 miles an hour, 230 miles an hour. 200 odd miles an hour.
You could get up to that on the M6 toll, though, when you pay a fiver.
Is that allowed? Page a fiver, break the land speed record. I'm not the only one who thinks...
No one pays the M6 toll and then does fucking 69, though, do they?
I honestly... think you, once you've paid £5.80, you should be allowed to do what fucking speed you want. It's a load of other Tories like...
I do. And it's a private road. There's no laws on it.
Nope.
Oh, hold on. I've heard that before, but then I see all the nope. signs about the
what
police.
What do you mean,
thing.
Nope?
Nope.
What do you mean?
Do you think because you paid £5.80, you can bury a woman's body or something? Yeah. What did you think? Ah, finally, I'm free of the laws of the land. I'm on the toll road. I've just shot six people.
Murder's murder. But you can... you can't get a speeding ticket there.
You can.
Fucking hell. He knows full well you can't. Come on. What speed have you been doing on the M6 toll road?
Whatever, until my car starts shaking.
I'd love to see it. I've paid my £5.80. I'm getting my fucking...
What's the point?
Can I just pay the fiver for that one 200 yards of chaos after the toll where there's no lanes?
I fucking love that bit, you know?
It's so good.
It's like the start of Mario Kart.
And you try and get the boost, and then you ghost from the last time you're on the yeah, M6.
Well, now that I know I'm breaking the law, next time my ghost's going to be fucking off, mate, and I'm just going to be like, I've never been caught though. I've hit 100 on the M6 toll.
If there's any police officers watching, you know where you can get your little.
This is a comedy podcast, and everything we say is for entertainment purposes only. Please don't take it seriously.
Oh, by the way, we are in the first line of that question that we didn't ask about 28 minutes ago.
23 minutes
ago. A Scally in Concert Square.
How fucking long was that conversation I sat out for?
Fucking ridiculous. And I'm honestly, Larry, it's been a pleasure having you. You've been gold dust. But sometimes we're basically just getting people into witness an argument.
I know. It's like you need to leave. I thought if I join in, it's going to be utter chaos.
No, you're the voice of reason. This is what I have to deal with. It's my business partner, my friend. Online knobhead.
You never leave the studio.
But right. You've paid £580. A Scally in Concert Square, Jesus Christ, offers you a pill. That's the end of it, what are you saying? No, he says, if you take it, you'll unlock infinite knowledge in your brain. You'll be the smartest man to have ever lived on the planet. But he warns you that the side effect of the pill is that you will shit yourself at unexpected times every day for the rest of your life. Larry, are you taking it? Basically, limitless, like that film with Bradley Cooper.
Yeah, because you'd begin to have some kind of like way of handling shit in yourself. Like,
oh yeah,
because it didn't say anything about not wearing a nappy or whatever like that.
Oh, that feels disappointing though, doesn't it? Limitless, you're literally a higher functioning human being wearing an adult nappy that smells of poo.
I know, but it means it's.
I've cured COVID.
I reckon I'm like a pizza and a milkshake away from being there anyway. So basically, what you're saying is, do you want to be where you're going to be in 5 years and dead clever, or where you're going to be in 5 years and as stupid as you are now? So yeah, I'm taking the pill.
It's basically not a hard question if you've got IBS already, yeah. Is it? Like, do you want to be cleverer or not?
But the problem I have with it is that it's a Scally in Concert Square, and you're sort of like, he might be lying here, and that's just a fucking Gary.
Yeah. Why does have to be that? That's what I'm thinking.
Can I just say?
Who would believe someone in the street that told you
that? Liam Witterick, you've made it more convoluted than it needs to be. I love the question, but basically, you've preempted it.
Fuck off!
Give us a character.
Think more about this question you sent us for free.
Liam Witterick, right. A guy comes up and he's got bloodstains on his collar and he smells a little bit like fish. As he coughs up phlegm onto the set, he offers you a pill. Like, that has sort of coloured the question, isn't it? But if a lab came and got in touch, like, hi, Larry, we're from Dead Good Medicine.
I wouldn't believe that. Fucking delete that one immediately.
Will you take this?
The reason why Neo took the pills off Morpheus in the Matrix is because he knew him. It wasn't Morpheus didn't just come up to him in the middle, and he saved his life already. He didn't just come up to him in the middle of a square and be like, "Hey, mate, just so you know, you're gonna learn about the whole."
So you're saying if a smackhead saved your life, so you're about to step in front of a boss and someone who stinks of piss, sweaty, clearly a bit fucking clicky, and he pulls you back. You're like, thanks, mate. And then he's like, do you want one of these, lads? You're like, absolutely.
I don't want to be rude.
It would have been a very different film, The Matrix, wouldn't it, if it had been some fucking skaghead from Concert Square. Like, yeah, lads, look, take a blue order, dads. I can't remember which one's which, but when people are shooting at you, you go fucking float on them, like, just whistle by, and you'd be dead good at your, like, tax return. It's like a big machine. I'd have Morpheus.
Yeah.
Well, Lawrence Fishburne in fucking glasses offers you drugs. A big black man offers like a pill. I'd be like, oh, that'd be fun.
Yeah. Oh, so he's wearing a leather jacket. How much cooler does he need to be in it?
Does that make you feel?
Oh, mate, the thing that his jacket does, like just when it's a bit windy and there's a wee bit at the bottom.
I think that's male privilege, that, you know. Because any woman who's approached by a man in a leather jacket offering pills is running a mile.
I think it depends on how big the jacket is, though, because a leather jacket that only goes down to your belt, you think, well, you're clearly a loser. And then if it goes longer, then...
hey, can I just...
That's all I wear!
Can I just say this is black privilege? Because if you have a leather coat that goes all the way to the floor and it flaps and you're a white guy, everyone's like, oh, it's you look like someone goth.
Yeah. It's not even just a goth. You look like someone who wanted to be a magician but didn't have the confidence.
Oh, yeah. And if you're a black guy, it's like, oh my God, let's take a pill together.
And so we've come to the end of the road.
End of the road.
It's been a really good 9 months, though. And I reckon, you know what? To get this far, we've done really well.
We've got to have a word, though.
Have we?
We've got to have a word.
It's time to have a word with Adam and Dan.
Oh, nope.
And then we've also got the hoodie to give away.
Yeah.
Oh, got some admin, mate.
But listening to you guys for the past hour or so, I cannot believe neither of you are like putting brand of offensive comedians. Because some of the shit I've heard on this podcast, I'm like, whoa, you've not been able to say that since 2002, guys.
Okay, so here's the thing, right? Because both of us, like, you know, we've done quite well in our careers, you know, we do quite well on the circus, right. The odd bit of TV here and there, but no one within the industry really gives a fuck about either of us, so they don't listen to this podcast.
You know how you've done Live at the Apollo? That's not worked out for me, so I'm going hard in the paint with this style of online content.
Hey, I'm not knocking it. I think it's fucking hilarious.
Well, from the start, like, our listenership sort of has pushed us, because at the start we were a bit sort of cheeky with each other. We didn't even really know each other that well at the start, but every bit of feedback was just like, just let it go. And we just like, we wanted it to be as close to like, this is what I always think. You know when a comic gets in trouble for something they said on stage? I'm always like, I'd love that. The person who complained about that to see what he said in the green room before he went on.
Yeah.
That conversation. And this is just a mild version of that.
Is that kind of thing of like, you know, the when you somebody takes it out of, if you were to look at most stand-ups conversations wrote down, but then if you actually see them or like actually live, you're like, oh, actually, yeah. And I suppose in the context of things, and you can tell by the tone of voice that they were only joking.
Also, from my experience, let me just say this on the fucking record, right?
God,
the more cunty a comic is on stage, you know, like the ones who say shit that they just think is funny, and they just, if someone gets upset, they get upset. They tend to be the nicest ones off stage, and the little creepy sort of, I've got a PowerPoint, they're the ones who are fucking fingering everyone.
Who we're talking about right now.
Do you know what I mean? Bill Cosby, clean as a fucking whistle. Audible bastard.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the ones who are like, just say shit because they think it's funny, they tend to be that nice and sweet and really nice guys.
Aye. Yeah. When I mentioned Frankie Boyle earlier, I was like, he's actually really, really nice.
Of course he is, because they're getting it out on stage. Like,
dark and, yeah, gruesome,
one of the nicest,
dead sound comic.
One of the nicest people I've met in comedy, in fact, the two nicest people I've met in comedy, sorry to you two, are Andrew Schultz and Jimmy Carr. And Jimmy Carr will say fucking anything on stage if he thinks it's funny. And Andrew Schultz is the same. Two of the nicest people I've ever met. Jim Jeffries is apparently lovely off stage, and he just says whatever he wants.
Adam, pick up our names because they don't do tour support.
Bill Burr. call me Bill. I sent you 7 texts.
Shall we do a have a word before we give away this hoodie? Adam was just saying before, he loves to have a word, and it's a solid way to... We're trying to solve problems here.
Right.
The last one we did got a little bit wordy. That was my fault. This one, short and sweet. Larry, we'd like you to help them out, okay?
Right.
Dan Kelly says, all right, lads, I'm going to read this in a Scouse accent because it's 100% a Scouser writing this in. All right, lads, have a word with me bird. She was eating ice cream the other night, and I had a go and used her spoon. She looked at me like I was bumming her ma... But she will happily put me bollocks in her mouth. I'm not the weird one here, am I? Have a word.
So she got pissed off that he borrowed her spoon and didn't get her own. But yeah. How long have they been together? They share more than fucking a bit of phlegm, don't they?
She puts bollocks in her mouth. She puts his bollocks in her mouth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's a fucking absolute knobhead.
That's fucking mental. I even think that thing of like, even... I mean, I wouldn't do it, but like, if you borrow someone's toothbrush, who you're about to fuck, it's like, who gives a shit? You're sharing your saliva anyway.
I think it is worth saying, though, a couple that shares a toothbrush, can, like, that's our toothbrush, they need help. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
We've just have one toothbrush for the two of us. Yeah. Oh, well.
It's still not as pathetic as someone who shares their Facebook profile. that's the ultimate of like, okay, well, one of you's been up to something.
That screams Stendu, doesn't it? We're going on a stag and hen do together.
The thing is, Becky's a lovely partner. She just doesn't let me have my own social media presence. Okay, Becky's a fucking psycho. And you fingered someone in Corfu.
In my experience, it's well more often that it with the Facebook stuff, the joint one, it's always the man who's the fucking, you're not seeing anyone. Defo.
Maybe.
In my experience.
Maybe. Well, I suppose I wouldn't be able to know in any experience. I would be like, no.
In my experience, men are more possessive than women.
Isn't what I'm actually thinking in my head of like, the way they used to talk about men and women, I'm actually thinking, is it top or bottoms that are more like this? That's usually the way that my lot do it.
Really? with bottoms, but that would be a weird, wouldn't it? If you're a submissive, but you're really controlling at the same time, like, pin me down, don't phone your sister. I want to be tied up, but you better not go and see your fucking friend for his birthday. That's a bit weird. It's a weird little juxtaposition.
Yeah, I suppose, but then I had a conversation with a comic about who comedians who tend to be, you know, like there's lower status and higher status, and like of like, I mean, I think most American comics you see are higher status because, you know, they're cool and all that, and then a lot most British ones are lower status.
Oh, yeah. Kind
of
like, yeah.
Sorry, everyone.
But we were saying that the comedians that tend to be higher status tend to be submissive in the bedroom, and lower status tend to be dominant in the bedroom. And I've not had sex with enough comedians to, but all not
enough comedians.
Yes,
have you fucked comics? I've never fucked a comic.
I've sucked a comic off, but I've not fucked a comic. I've not been in like.
This podcast is gonna end really interestingly. This will be a new one.
I thought we talked about blowjobs. Then I mean, oh fuck! Last night I received a blowjob. And
why in my voice?
I don't know.
Every time I get my dick sucked, okay, I go a little bit northern.
Jesus Christ! Oh. No, Brexit means Brexit.
I got a new tattoo yesterday morning, and it's, you know, Gizmo from Gremlins, but it's him. But he's I didn't realize the way he's facing. He's staring
at your dick.
Yeah. So, but he makes eye contact if someone's sucking it. Apparently. As I found out when they were laughing during.
What the fuck? Why did you get the tattoo of Gizmo that close to your dick?
Well, because there was a mole there I wanted to cover up. So
make that his bubble! Don't get it wet.
Oh, that's a really realistic tattoo of the Gruffalo. It's got really... he's got knobbly knees. Well, actually, it's a
You haven't got tattoos, have you?
No.
If you were going to get one, is there something you would get covered up? I'd just get an eye patch, me.
I've got...
Just go black, the whole thing.
But then your eye is still open. Like, oh, that'd be so weird. You'd just look like half a panda. I get
that would bring so much more attention to it as well. Like, what's up with... Oh.
So, Arrow, this is weird, isn't it?
You know, Dean Coughlin has done our artwork that we're sending out to the £10 patrons. Now that we know a talented tattoo artist, I would love to get one done before. Like, it's one of them things. It's not going to be Gizmo or the Gruffalo. But I would. But I've got bad skin. I've got a bit of, like, crappy skin. I don't know if it's just going to fucking annoy it. That's why I've never
got one. If I got one, I would get Newton's cradle on my chest and make me nipples look like the balls.
That's good.
That would take How fat would you have to get to be to get them? If I had big, like, if I was a woman and I had and my tits were going, then you'd definitely, come on, they're going anyway. You might as well do Newton's Cradle and just be like, kids, watch this.
Have I told you why I haven't got tattoos? Because when I was like 10, I wanted to be a fucking bad skem fucking wool and get the Liverbird because I'm a kid. I'm like, I'm a Liverpool fan. Ugh, it creeps me out now. I want to get like a Liverbird there.
Sorry, about 5% of our listeners have got that tattoo, by the way.
Look,
sorry, guys.
Fair play to you, but I think it's a bit fucking shite. And I wanted to get it. And my mum went to me. She's pissed on the couch. She's a bit fucking out of it. And she goes, you can't ever get a tattoo. And this is why. if you get one and you'd ever like murder someone, you'd be too easy to identify.
Oh yeah.
That was her life advice. I like how much faith she had in me as a human.
That guy with the gremlins tattoo, he fucking said a dead baby joke. and buried it in the M6 tool.
Can I just tell you, if you're doing dead baby jokes while that tattoo is visible, then that's your own fucking doing.
Yeah. That's a weird party.
Here's me dick, here's me tattoo, and then knock, knock.
Harry, you suit this podcast a lot, by the way. You've tuned into this very well.
Oh, it's lad bands, mate.
Bit of Formula One. Bit of gay banner.
We even talked about boobs at the end. I'm blending in.
This is me before I came out. Yeah, man. Let's
talk about the vibe.
Do you know what? Question for you. Because you've mentioned this on stage before. You're not a camp man. So you when you tell people in the audience that you're gay, sometimes it's a surprise, isn't it?
Yeah.
So were your family surprised?
No.
No,
they fucking smell it, man.
Really?
Well, because my brother was like, oh, I could tell because you didn't have any girlfriends and you're 23. I was like, well, it's either he's gay or a loser. And then my dad
said... Isn't that a confidence instilling in you, though, that he went straight to gay and didn't really consider the loser? He's either gay or a loser, and not Lally's not a fucking loser.
Actually, you spun it in a nice way, actually. I was like, I could tell until before. And then my dad was like, oh, I could tell because you wore jewellery. I was like, Dad, it's a ring. Apparently, this means I'm a bender in Glasgow. But my mum as well. I think as I told them years before, and then they were like, oh, that's a phase. And I was like, when I was 23, I was like, just so you know, that phase, that's still happening, by the way.
What? You... That's so not of this era now. Now, if a teenage lad came out of him, like, oh my God, we're going to be so supportive. Back in the day, it was like, I'm gay. I know you know. You're fucking. That's a fees.
I think I'd be terrified now if, like, even like as a homophobe as well, you'd be like thinking, oh no, if I'm not okay with this, they're going to post about it on social media and there's going to get loads of retweets.
My dad told me to leave.
To be fair, I saw a video the other day and of this person accepting like her child coming out as gay, and I'm like, why are you videoing your kid coming out as gay to you, like, and then trying to basically using it as a leverage to get likes on social media? I was like, that's fucking weird, man. Like, I'd rather my parents hated me for being gay than
like when people post about like their mum being dead and stuff, and you're just like, ugh.
Yeah,
call back to
it. I don't usually talk about it's always that shit of I don't usually talk about my personal life on here, and you're just like,
he's just done it.
Don't usually.
He was doing a joke, and you sort of lent into it. You're like, yeah.
You didn't realize the other 2 days ago it was the anniversary of my mum's death, and I did a big post about how I don't like these posts. We spoke about it earlier in the episode before you got here. It's really fucking funny. I'm with you as well, by the way. Whenever I say it, I'm like, ugh!
Oh well, I think we can. I mean, I think we can agree.
And I feel exactly the same when a gay person comes out.
Although, how'd
you do it?
You did that thing with Freddie Quinn in Edinburgh, that rap battle thing.
Yeah.
How long after your mum had died was that?
About a year.
All right, within a year, you were 11 months. Having jokes done about it on stage to you.
Yeah, that's I'm not right. Sensitive though. Like, do you know what I mean? Like, yeah. I can't be the comic that I like being and sort of making inappropriate jokes and then tell someone you can't make an inappropriate joke.
Yeah.
I did, like, the night after my mum died, I went and did a gig, and it was one of the best, like, probably wasn't, but it felt like one of the best gigs I've ever had.
Of course, you had a terrible day the day before. Of course.
Yeah, just in comparison, just like, this is really good, actually. Day,
I just had a toffee crisp, and it was wonderful, you know, because it wasn't the saddest thing that's happened to me in my life.
But yeah, I on the day, I think we've mentioned this on the show, but we might not have actually. On the day my mum died, so all the family come to the house, Carl was woken up by his girlfriend who said, just go round to Adam's, his mum's dad, because it happened overnight. Mm-hmm. And his missus woke him up and sent him round. And then a lot of the family dispersed, but me, my dad, my little brother, my mum's sister, my auntie, and Carl went to the pub by ours just to have a few pints and just deal with it, however. And me and Carl are quite partial to it, your ma. Joke, right? Mm. But obviously on that day, quite a heavy day, but you're just in the habit of it. So I went to get us some nuts, please. I'd like some nuts or something like that. And he went, your ma loves salty nuts. And then the blood that drained, I had him. Do you know what I mean? I just had him. I've never seen him look that uncomfortable. 12 years we've been best mates, and he was just like, too soon? Like panting. And I was just dead smug. Like, it didn't hurt me at all. I was just like, oh, this is so...
Yeah,
I just felt the power in my hands. I was like, I can make him feel as bad as I want.
That's fucking wake.
She was still
so, yeah, Freddie Quinn, 11 months later, didn't quite get me because 11 hours after she'd passed, he was like, your mom wants salty nuts.
Oh, no wonder then. Yeah. At the same time, though, you know that there's people that will, like, they'll be... Oh, I'm trying to think. All right, so say I had a bad coming out story, whatever, but then if someone did a joke about it, then there's some people that if they were in that situation, they would be like, no jokes about it for forever.
Yeah.
But like, well, what's the fucking... Because you're not saying that thing of like Richard Pryor, like, so I just noticed the poster behind you, of like when he was talking about how his dad's funeral and his mum and stuff, and the thing of him going on fire and stuff like that. And then when you kind of realise that all that stuff was true, rather than there be a sad bit in the show, because he doesn't do any sad bits in the show, but you realise it's all true at the end and you go, fuck, I can't believe I actually laughed at that, rather than going, oh God.
It's real comedy though.
Comedy and tragedy are so close together. There's a very thin line between it. And I don't really do much of it anymore, but I do have that comic thing in me where when something shit happens, I'm like, I might get a bit out of that.
Yeah.
I think it's a very sort of British comic thing to do. Go, oh, tragedy. Well, that'll be a routine in a year or whatever.
I had that when he laughed when he gave me a blowjob last night.
Isn't it brutal? And you're like, oh, that's going to be a bit.
Oh, it absolutely will be a bit.
Nothing, darling. Just let me do that.
But Larry, do you not find it suspicious when comics are touchy about stuff? I know we're not like inhuman and I know there's buttons you can press, but when a comic's like, hey, it's not all right to joke about that. I almost feel like, yeah, you're not a proper comic then.
Yeah, no, totally. But a lot of the stuff I see online, on any social media stuff, the virtue signaling. Yeah. There's some people I believe that actually think this stuff, and I'm like, cool, that's your thing, because I've got like I think Russell Keane once told me that when he became famous, he picked one charity, and that was because he thought, I'll put all my energy into that one charity. And I kind of believe that with a lot of people. But then sometimes, I mean, when the Black Lives Matter thing was happening a few months, one of my exes, well, not ex, but it was like a guy I went on a couple of dates with, used the N-word when we were on one of those dates. And then, and he does have a lot of racist tendencies, hence it didn't really go anywhere. And he's posting about Black Lives Matter. And I'm it's a virtue signaling thing because it's like, it makes him look good that he's part of this thing, but he definitely doesn't believe it. And I think a lot of comics do that as well. It's like, you don't believe this. You just know this is a good 50-minute mark.
You just like the look of a bandwagon and go, oh, I'm going to jump on this.
All the fucking time. And I just make a note of it in my head. And they're just immediately someone who I will never trust.
I would love to see Adam's shit list written out here.
I'll tell you about the Patreon episode.
Have you got a list? Have you got a list of like fucking comics who you're just like, well, I don't trust you?
There's people I don't trust, but then it seems sometimes you have to kind of, because the problem of being self-employed, you have to kind of be like, well, I need to be nice to them because then...
Yeah. Oh yeah, no, there's a total difference between being polite and being two-faced. Like there's comics who I don't trust and don't like, but if I'm in a green room with them, I'm like, hey mate, you're all right. Yeah, right. I'm going to watch, and I'll watch their set and I'll be like, oh, that was great. But I won't be like, do you want to go for a pint? That's when it becomes two-faced, isn't it?
Yeah.
Like, when you're friends, when you're trying to be, not just comedy, like sound in the dressing room, mates.
Let's go for a coffee. And then you're on the phone as soon as they've gone up to be for a coffee with that fucking cunt. That's horrible. Just don't do that.
But then, I don't know, I've bitched about comics before that I regret. And then, I usually, when I bitched about them, in the middle of it, I'm saying, I'm just jealous. Because it's always when something good's happened for them. And I'm just jealous. But I think when everyone gets that thing of like, oh, you fucking did. And you're like, oh, actually, they're really nice.
I made a very conscious, I think I've mentioned it. I made a very conscious decision a few years ago. Because when I started stand-up, obviously, a similar time to you, my mates were like Brennan Rees and Pete Otway. And they just took off faster than I did. And I was jealous of them. I was like, why are they getting a weekend at the Frog and I can barely get a Thursday and shit like that. And then I made a very conscious decision like a couple of years later to just be like, you've got to be the opposite of that. And genuinely since then, I'd never really get jealous of me mates. Like when Brennan Rees told me I've got live at the Apollo, I just hugged him immediately. I was like, lad, that's so sick. I was genuinely just happy for him because it's such an individual art form and something that someone else is doing just doesn't matter.
Fucking Brennan. That cunt did live at the Apollo.
He did. I slagged you off when you got it.
It's good if you can get there.
I genuinely started doing the same 6 months ago, I think. Oh, was it 6 months? I didn't even know my time. About a year ago, I probably started doing this. It was around about last year I started doing the same thing because I was thinking, why am I even being fucking bitter about this? Because I know people hated it when I got anything. And I was like, and I was thinking, well, that's unfair because they don't realize of the stuff I've had to do to get this stuff. Yeah. And I don't realize the stuff that they've had to do to get their stuff. And
also, you've put the fucking work in. You play pretty much every club in the country. You can close them all and you've had several successful albums. But that, like, the bitterness in the industry is there's still going to be old guys who think they've worked harder going, if they just needed a gay with an accent.
Totally. That's the thing though. But I was beginning to think, I felt a bit of a, you know, when you can go, oh God, I've been such a hypocrite. Because I was beginning to be like, oh, I can't believe they're doing that to me. And then I was thinking, I do that as well, what a cunty thing. So I made myself stop doing it. But I think it was because somebody changed my Wikipedia. My mate was like, somebody I went on a date with, they said, your Wikipedia's really weird. I was like, well, first of all, they're omitting the summer Wikipedia on the first date. But then I read it and I was like, oh, that is really weird. Because it was saying, somebody edited it saying I was a massive fraud and started bitching about me.
I've just got to break this to you, right? So Wikipedia are actually quite good at when something like that happens, reverting it quite quickly. So it sounds to me like he did that.
That is true.
Mate, that must be weird. That was
a reference to me being a dick.
Mate, that must be weird being single and having a Wikipedia. Do you know when you're like, let's check the Facebook and let's go through about Insta and let's check Wikipedia. Like, that's got to be a bit weird.
Yeah, but it's usually a telltale sign that I won't like them. Because then right. It's like, who fucking goes to that much? Before meeting someone, who goes to, like, who Googles them?
Yeah.
It's like checking a fucking register.
The furthest I go when I'm about to meet a girl is I'll find out where her parents live and just go and drive around and make sure it's a nice neighbourhood. But other than that, I don't really look into them.
Imagine if they reference your material and they're trying to bang you. Like, they're just about to give you a blowjob. You're like, oh, Gizmo, like from the Have a Word podcast. All right, let's do this.
So anyway, yeah.
Nice to meet the fans.
So, so you think that she should share a spoon?
Oh God, sorry.
Yeah, it's so ridiculous.
Yeah, she should share the fucking spoon. Get over yourself. Share a toothbrush just to punish her as well. Ridiculous.
We're giving this away. We have milked this fucking competition for all it's worth. Larry, will you pick a name out of there, please?
We've had. Thank you very much. We had hundreds and hundreds of entries for this, and
pull
it's
one out. Just
it's
pull
a one of three
out.
Orange hoodie, and we very much appreciate it. Who has won?
cleaner of
Josh
Evans.
Josh Evans.
Welcome, clap it. Josh Evans, you get the hoodie. We'll be in touch, or you'll be in touch, or whatever, and we'll send you the hoodie. And you can have two free tickets to any show you ever want to come to. Only once. Steady on, Josh. But yeah, there you go. Congrats and commiserations to the 17,000 other people who entered.
Thanks for coming, Larry. That's been an absolute pleasure.
That's a fucking epic. That's an hour and a half with Larry, and we did over an hour before. Beautiful. It's a fucking long one. It's going to be great.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for having me.
Where can everyone find you? Your shit, and have you got anything you want people to go and watch? Or
I don't know. That's a fucking...
What's your Instagram handle?
Larry Dean Comedy. I'm on Larry Dean Comedy on all my social media shit. So.
Sweet. Thanks for coming in, and I hope you come back again in a few months.
I always think that bizarre at the end of... Sorry. I always think it's bizarre at the end of episodes because it'll be like, if they really like you, they'll try and find you anyway.
That's just no, good. People are lazy, man. Really? People are just like, we had... We did a show recently where me and Dan were both on, and most of the people who came were because of the podcast.
Aye.
And then Brennan Rees did it with us, and we did the gig. And then last week when he was on, I was like, thank God he's on, because I loved him so much at the show that you did, but I just forgot his name.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah, people are fucking lazy.
People keep supporting live comedy because people say at the end of their sets. No,
that's exactly what it is.
Stay safe.
Oh, my
that's
God,
the
yeah.
Keep supporting live comedy. Stay safe, guys. And don't get bum flu.
Oh, yeah, I forgot all about the pandemic until Dan reminded me at the end of his...
Guys, just visit your local cinema and don't get bum flu. And stay safe and keep supporting live comedy.
Visit your local cinema and don't get bum flu. That is the new motto of the Have A Word podcast.
Thanks, Larry.
Thank you, guys.
Cheers, man.